My name is Miguel Rojas-Sotelo, and on behalf of the Consortium in Latin American and Caribbean Studies, I welcome you all to these first conversations. 35 years ago, Latin America was in the middle of what was called la década perdida, the lost decade. The external debt of most of the countries of the region reached a point of no return, producing deep economic contractions and hyperinflations. Many currencies collapsed, as well as the ideas of job security and the welfare state. There are many explanations, but most scholars agreed that opening the door for a kind of economic and social experiment instrumentalized at the end of some of the military dictatorships in the Southern Cone, and then expanded by the multilateral organisms across the region, consolidated after the fall of the Berlin Wall and the end of the Soviets, that we know it as an economic neoliberalism. The opening of the borders after decades of proteccionismo, directed to bring the region to the promises of the industrial age, and with it, organized labor and the mobility of social mobility and welfare, gave space then to deindustrialization and privatization of the public sector. At this point, the national film industries also collapsed, and the so-called Nuevo Cine Latinoamericano, Third Cinema, which wrote on the depiction of el pueblo, the people, came to an abrupt end. Argentina came out of the military dictatorships and embraced the opening of their markets and borders. The failure of many industries and banks to adapt, which will happen also during la segunda década perdida, the second lost decade in the 2010s, brought people such as Raúl Alfonsín and Menem, who followed the book of the IMF and then the Kirchners, changing the country to its current shape, as well as it did Brazil, which used the high commodity prices of the oil boom during the petroleum boom in the late 1970s and 1980s to industrialize further, but with a high tag on international loans. Fernando Collor de Mello's government crumbled while trying to control prices with little success, giving space to Fernando Enrique Cardoso. Yes, that the one that wrote La Teoría de la Dependencia, Dependence Theory, and who barely stabilized the economy by liberalizing and shrinking the public sector, bringing a decade plus of growth later by Lula da Silva and Dilma until what has happened now, stories to be told. The Chile of Pinochet suffered deeply during its first decade, becoming more controlling than the one before, which could detonate social protests against the military government, until the full implementation by the Chicago Boys and their book, and by Minister Hernán Bucci, which created at first great wealth, very located, a sense of economic security that has been proven wrong today, and that by the end of the 1980s, in 1990, will bring democracy, as we will be seeing in the film No, later in the film festival week. Soon Mexico, Venezuela, Colombia, Peru, and other countries will follow, each with its own version of neoliberalism, democracy, growth, and sudden collapse. Many of you were born before 1985, Generation X, and enjoy the remnants of the romantic rural life of Latin America, the echoes of other eras. Others of you were born at the middle of it, well, the so-called millennials, knowing only exhilaration as the cities of the South grew to become some of the largest of the planet. Some of you were born and grew in affluent enclosed condos or in middle or working class neighborhoods or even shanty towns and favelas. We all have lived over these tribulations. Living through upheavals is like Brazilian visual artist Eliud Tzica once said, in a scarcity we thrive, end quotes. Many of you, our students, that had been born at the edge of the new century or just over Gen Z, have normalized such changes, living within languages, within rhythms, among cultures. Each story is different as nations nations are. Each is peculiar, each is special. That's why little spaces like these try to share some aspects of such diversity in a very compacted form. For those of us working from the North, from here, the US, on issues of Latin America and the Caribbean, cinema and cinema, big cinema, fictional and documentary as well, experimental short animations and many other formats of media, give us a window to the changing social and cultural and economic landscape of the multiple realities taking place south of the border. Here also, since Latin America lives within the diasporas of the Latinos and the Latinx communities in the United States and Canada. Those transformations had taken thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of people through epic journeys across the landscapes of the Americas, or as First Nations call it, Abia Yala, land in potential, land in full fruition, or Pachamama, who proves to be hard as a mother, but never abandons, opening new chapters to this long tale of the Americas. The experience of desarraigo, deterritorialization, had also transformed the culture of the United States, as we know, becoming an economic imperative in late capitalism. Here, Latinos, a second-class citizens serving in every industry, but also they could bring change to its political reality if all of them and you counted go to vote, while also keeping a lifeline for many of our countries in the form of remittances, las remesas. These telluric transformations had taken a short 3.5 decades. The last part of the 20th century and this first 2 decades of the 21st has seen, and to summarize, the end of the civil wars in Central America and the continuous participation of foreign interests in the region, the consolidation of democracy after military rule, and a sort of transitions of power, always contested, but mostly peaceful. The pink tide, la movida de izquierda, with all its social promises, transformations, and sour consequences, and a return of conservative rule, with dictation. The rise of an emerging business criminal class, at times corrupting entire governments and unleashing tides of violence and chaos of great proportions that parallel in size and reach to the great economic conglomerate, resulting in the neoliberal policies, which had also been transforming the local cultures into fully globalized ones. Now all of us are consumers. And finally, we are also seeing the cultural revival and reconstruction de los pueblos originarios, indigenous peoples, that have taken back their rights and as a storm are starting to make important gains in their autonomy, representation and control over their ancestral territories. A new ethnic struggle that side by side with the experiences and struggles of Afro descendants and social movements led by women, LGBT activists, all workers, teachers, keep asking for full participation in the building of their nation states. There are rare opportunities to get together in spaces such as this. We give our gratitude to the global pandemic, gracias COVID, que nos pones a todos juntos en un espacio como este, to share the work of scholars working on trying to disentangle these realities from their own disciplinary spaces. I am deeply honored and very humbled to see them all here in these conversations that we have titled Latin American Film in the Era of Neoliberalism, 1985-2020, that is part of the 35th North Carolina Latin American Film Festival, an event organized by the Consortium in Latin American and Caribbean Studies at UNC, Chapel Hill, and Duke University, and made possible with funding from the US Department of Education and the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation. Thank you all for joining us. Muchas gracias a todos por estar aquí. Now it is my great pleasure to see a friend from our days in grad school back in Pittsburgh, Western Pennsylvania, to be our first speaker for this conversation. Salomé Aguilera Skvirsky, assistant professor from the Department of Cinema and Media Studies, University of Chicago. She will be followed by Professor Laura Podalsky from the Department of Spanish at Ohio State University, and Manuel Sánchez Cabrera, one of our own, from the Department of Romance Languages from the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill. Thank you very much for being here. And without any other ado, Salomé.
Hi, everyone. Miguel, thank you so much for inviting me to participate in this event with scholars that I so admire, and with you and with the audience. I'm really happy to be here. When Miguel first wrote me about this event, he invited me to talk about my recently published book with Duke called The Process, Genre, Cinema, and the Aesthetic of Labor. Oh, wait, let me share my screen. Sorry. Pause. Here we go. I'm still getting used to this format. Okay. So when he first wrote me, you know, I worried that the book was not centered on Latin American cinema. It isn't exactly about Latin American cinema, though a few chapters focus on Latin American examples. Still, the idea for the book came from my work on Latin American nonfiction films, and the shape the book took was deeply marked by these Latin American cases. I thought I'd talk a little bit about that today, both for its methodological interest and because in a certain sense, it's an instance of quite literally globalizing Latin American cinema. Okay, so a little bit about how the project started. I think you'll get a sense of the interest of it as I, the kind of general interest of it as I go on. Okay, so I had traveled to Brazil to do research for a dissertation on the representation of race in Brazilian cinema. With some luck, I managed to find the filmmaker of a 20-minute documentary titled Quilombo. It was 1975. The film is from 1975. Quilombo is the Portuguese word for maroon society. Apart from what its title suggested, I knew nothing about the film. I couldn't find a description of it, and I didn't know whether any copies survived. The filmmaker, Vladimir Carvalho, informed me that there was in fact a copy, but only one, he thought. A 16-millimeter print housed in at the office of the state-run Centro Técnico Audiovisual in Rio de Janeiro. He generously agreed to arrange a private screening for me. He did so with the warning that his film was probably not what I was looking for. I wouldn't find much evidence of Afro-Brazilian culture in it, he said. The film is about a contemporary quilombo, not a historical one. And the people it was about, well, he said, they were devout Catholics, not practitioners of an Afro-Brazilian religion such as Candomblé. Carvalho was right to suppose that based on its title, I expected the film to be about so-called African cultural survivals and that I would be totally unprepared for its actual subject matter. Okay. So I'll explain this in a second. Okay, so these are a set of frame enlargements from a sequence that I'm gonna show you in a second. But Quilombo is about the subsistence activities of a then contemporary community of peasants who were descendants of escaped slaves and lived in a small rural village, Mesquita, an hour outside of the nation's capital city of Brasilia. The people of Mesquita had survived for generations through subsistence farming and the annual production of quince marmalade. The film is structured around the community's production of saleable quince marmalade for the local market. With rigorous attention to the details of the process, the film displays two necessary activities in that production. One, the production of the marmalade itself and the fabrication of small rectangular wooden boxes to contain it. Okay, so I've drawn in green, I've traced the frames, the frame enlargements that have to do with the first process, the production of the quince marmalade itself, and then in pink, the production of the boxes. So intercutting back and forth, you know, it's a short film, Between these two activities, the film presents the necessary steps in chronological order. The quince tree is planted, its flowers bloom, the rain comes, the fruit ripens, then the quince is picked and tossed into metal buckets, etc. So I just want to show you the clip that this is a kind of abstraction from. I should say one thing, the audio is very difficult to hear. When I first worked on this film, I did a transcription of it. I don't have the subtitles here now, and I'd really like you to focus on the images for the moment. Okay.
Aqui no município do Rio de Janeiro, meu conhecimento acabou tudo. A falta de assistência, como diz a assistência médica, a falta do sulfato de cobre, e o comprozão azul, que se eu detesto, e a adubação também, fazer uma adubação perfeita. Não queria que fosse dado, não. Se existisse um posto de venda aqui, era importante. Seria o lucro da venda do próprio posto, e seria muito desenvolvimento na produção, tanto para o proprietário como para o município. Adubação de cobertura, uma adubação perfeita com grão, com fertilizante, não dá volta. O marinheiro atua muito anos, o marinheiro tem vida para até para 200 anos.
Okay, so as I watched Carvalho's film at the Centro Técnico, I felt something familiar, a kind of tingling in my toes and ears, a calm, a stillness, a lull. I was transfixed. I had experienced this before watching film, and most recently it had been, I'd felt it watching the US filmmaker Robert Flaherty's 1934 film, Man of Erin, a few months before my trip to Brazil. Seeing the Aran Islanders preparing an impossibly rocky plateau for the growing of potatoes by retrieving seaweed from the rock's crevices and watching a young Aran man patch up a hole in a fishing boat with a piece of cloth, tar, and heat had elicited the same sensation. So I want to show you a clip from Man of Aran. Okay, So when I spoke with Carvalho about the screening, I hesitated to mention the Flaherty. I imagined that he might be offended by the comparison to a master of the Anglo-American world, that he might feel somehow that I was somehow suggesting his film was derivative. But when eventually I did bring up Flaherty, Carvalho grew very animated. He said that it was seeing Man of Erin as a young man at a cine club in the city of João Pessoa in Paraíba, Brazil, that had set him on his career path. Well, it was seeing the similarities between his film and Flaherty that set me on the path that led to the writing of the book. I began by wondering what accounted for the mesmerism of the two films. How is the effect achieved? Eventually, I came to think that I had stumbled on a discrete genre, the process genre, and that this genre was indeed global. Before that, I'd felt badly constrained by disciplinary boundaries and by the often unacknowledged practice that made Latin America the site for case studies and not for the production of globally relevant theories. I was working in the area of Latin American film studies in an English department, and my project was supposed to be about Latin American nonfiction filmmaking. Surely there was some grand theory of this kind of representation of process that might be applicable to my Latin American cases, but I couldn't find one. And that's what made me think that I'd found something worth thinking about and writing about and with a kind of broader interest. But because I came to the process genre through an encounter with Carvalho's work, I was attentive to certain of its features that otherwise would not have been salient. Although his work was understudied at the time, Carvalho is an important and interesting figure in Brazilian cinema. He was central in the Paraíban school of documentary, which overlapped with the Cinema Novo movement of the 60s and 70s. And for more than 50 years, impervious to all faddishness, he's pursued a single project, basically making democratic films about work and workers. In the first part of that career, he made several films that, like Quilombo, were very beautiful and deceptively straightforward films depicting the ordered steps in a process of craft labor. So there was one about the making of rapadura, or raw brown sugar. That film is Abolandeira, 1969. There was a film about the production of cotton, O País de São Saruê, 1971, that was banned for several years or censored. There was one about the mining of scheelite, in A Pedra da Riqueza, 1976. There was one about the art of weaving, Mutirão, in 1978. Later, Carvalho would turn to telling the story of the construction of the city of Brasília, of how laborers bust in from the distant northeast of the country, built an entire city from scratch in the middle of the country's central plateau, and in 4 years, of how the workers had had few protections, of how several had died, of how they had suffered terrible indignities, of how this utopian city designed to banish class differentiation had no place for these candangos, as they were called when it was completed, of how they were exiled from the city they had built and forced to live in impoverished, poorly serviced satellite cities, of how their attempts to organize and demand a different future had met with state violence and repression. In his 70th decade of life, Carvalho described his artistic trajectory in an interview with the great Brazilian film critic, Carlos Alberto Matos. On three separate occasions, Carvalho's father, who he described as a compulsive builder, built what would be for a time their family's home using bricks and tiles that were produced on site. Okay, here's the quote, I'm gonna read it. So, I do not doubt, Carvalho said, that my vocation documenting the land and labor was born as I watched the work of the men who extracted and piled the red clay, immediately adding river water that had been painfully brought on the backs of the beasts of burden. Kneaded sensuously with their feet, the clay became easy to form and filled with wood molds, ultimately to be transformed into bricks and tiles arranged into pyramids, and later baked in a fire pit on the festive night of the burning of the kiln. The dirty men of that generous soil were practically an extension of the land, much like those others who nearby plowed the land. I learned that everyone was transforming the world into culture. Indeed, Carvalho's entire oeuvre exhibits an unwavering curiosity about and awe for people's capacity to make and remake the world. His stance toward the considerable practical intelligence of those dirty men of clay, as he calls them elsewhere, and the rigorous, uncompromising way he makes one feel the force of those capacities without falling into a mawkish sentimentality, means that his early films about production processes exhibit not so much an aesthetic of hunger, the term coined by Cinema Novo's foremost cineast and theorist, Glober Rocha, to mark an imperfect aesthetic matching a rough, immiserated human and geographic landscape, not so much that as an aesthetic of labor. That is, they exhibit an aesthetic that makes palpable the awesome transformative potential of human labor. Coming to my topic through Carvalho, rather than a more conventional route through what is known as industrial or educational filmmaking, stamped the material unmistakably. So let me say a little bit more about the category of the process genre, and then I'll end with a fun contemporary Cuban spoof. Okay, so the process genre, as you can kind of, as you're gathering from the examples and the way I'm talking about it, is characterized by the special way it organizes the representation of processes. So our contemporary landscape is awash with examples. The process genre is everywhere, present across history, media, and media platforms. Think of YouTube instructional videos and hands and pans high-speed video recipe tutorials widely shared on social media. Okay, so this one is, this is lasagna stuffed peppers. It's gonna loop. This is 2017's most popular tasty hands and pans video, and it's a process film. So on television, all manner of lifestyle, do-it-yourself, and educational programs employ a processual syntax. In the sphere of cinema, the category includes industrial, educational, ethnographic films since the early 1900s. So it encompasses what has been called the process film, a set of early films made between 1906 and 1917 about industrial and artisanal production processes, with titles like The Fan Industry in Japan, 1907, How They Make Cheese in Holland, 1909, The Manufacture of Walking Sticks, 1912. Some of the films depicted processes of industrial production, like A Visit to Peak Freen and Company's Biscuit Works. Others depicted artisanal production, making hats, making bamboo hats in Java, 1911. The films were made by operators from around the world, and examples abound in early French, Dutch, American film catalogs and archives. Most film manufacturers even had a special category in their listings for these films. Pathé called them scenes of art and industry, while the American Mutoscope and Biograph Company called them industrials. So the category includes here, for example, a partial inventory of especially significant process films whose processual character has gone largely unremarked. And I'll just point out one thing, and that is that El Velador, which is a film that's part of this series, is to my mind a process film. And so my opening title slide was frame enlargements from the final shot of that film. I won't talk about it. I don't want to spoil it here, but that's kind of part of the category. So there are also, here's a kind of idiosyncratic selection of Latin American titles. It's quite small, but I'm sure you can see some of them. Also belonging to the process genre are chronophotographic motion studies. For example, this one is from Edward Muybridge. You've probably seen this kind of thing before. So included too are craft and machine demonstrations such as those that have taken place at international expositions, crafts fairs, living, as well as traditional museums. Here's a contemporary illustration of visitors to the 1851 Great Exhibition watching a cotton machine demonstration. Also included is what E.H. Gombrich termed pictorial instructions, including everything from airplane safety brochures to the plates of Diderot's encyclopedia. here's this example. Discursive media recipes and instruction manuals also belong to the category. The enumeration could go on, you get the point. So although the genre has a life in a range of media, I contend that it achieves its fullest expression in moving image media, not least because of the medium's constitutive capacity to visually and analytically decompose movement and to create its recomposition. So the process genre, I think, is what I would call a cine genre. So I've given you a kind of sense of what classes of media are included, but now I want to review in a bit more detail in the time that I've left the formal qualities of this phenomenon. Okay, so the most important commonality across the examples of the process genre is formal. They're all structured by a distinctive representational syntax, what I'm calling processual representation. In addition to this and flowing from it, the sequences tend to produce a surprising degree of absorption in the spectator, like the absorption I described watching Quilombo and Man of Erin earlier. Furthermore, they all depict labor, capaciously understood, and technique, and they do so in such a way as to evoke something of the sensuous encounter of the body, instruments, and materials. Finally, the sequences or the examples provide or convey the impression of having provided knowledge about the world. So these common characteristics shouldn't be taken as hard and fast criteria of the process genre, nor does this inventory pretend to be exhaustive. For this occasion, I only want to talk a bit about the first, processual representation, and then I'll end by showing you a clip of a contemporary spoof. Okay. So this definitive feature, as I said, is processual representation, in which the important steps of the process are shown in chronological order with an identifiable beginning, middle, and end. Processual representation renders pro-filmic processes visible as processes. And there are two parts to this. There's the process and there's its representation. So a process, to put it crudely, is a continuous series of steps or actions that have a particular result and contain a definite order of steps. Process, whether in terms of actual screen time or symbolically, is the thematic center of all process films. But process films are processual in their form as well as their content. So processual representation is a formal achievement. Not just any representation of process is a processual one. In fact, most representations of processes are not processual. They convey what is done, not how it is done. So imagine that one has been tasked with representing toothbrushing on film. Toothbrushing is a process. It unfolds in time. It has a beginning, a middle, and a moment when it is completed. But there are different ways to represent it. I could show a 5-second shot of a child, Rosa, unscrewing the cap on a tube of toothpaste, and in the next 3-second shot, show her leaving the bathroom. This would be a representation of a process, but not a processual representation of toothbrushing. While the imagined scene suggests that Rosa brushed her teeth, it gives no sense of toothbrushing. As being comprised of a series of steps with a beginning, middle, and end. So only processes can be represented processually. Not all representations of processes are processual, but it's also the case that not all processes are well suited to processual representation. So processual representation often resembles a how-to. Conversely, the standard form of the how-to, whether it's a recipe or a diagram illustrating how to activate the flotation device of a crashing airplane, say, it's processual. It has a beginning, it has an end, and a series of successive linearly ordered actions in between. While not every processual representation is intended as a how-to, and while many processual representations actually function as effective guides to action, one can often recognize processual representation by its prescriptive valence. So I just want to end by showing you a little clip from a film from 2008 called The Making of 40 Rectangular Pieces of a Floor Construction by the Cuban artist Adrian Melis. And I just wanna, so it's a 5-minute and 20-second film. It starts on a black screen, there are ambient sounds, and there's this dialogue between a foreman, so you can't see anyone, and a worker. And the foreman says, come on, see about him. Julio, come here. You're wasting your time there doing nothing. A man's voice, perhaps Julio's replies, "Listen, dude, we've got no materials, no work, nothing. What do you want me to do? What do you want me to produce? Let's move and work." And the worker says, "You know, listen, dude, we've got no materials." And then he says, "You know, let's move and work. Listen, I'm going to be the cement trombone, and you be the pick and shovel, and you be the one who," and then it kind of breaks off. "Come on, you start." And the first image appears. So it has the typical frame of a process film, but it's a parody. So let me play it for you, and then I'll end. I just want to give you a kind of sense of it, of the way that the genre is commenting on itself.
Arriba, pintarme ese güey. Julio, ven acá.
Okay, so I'll stop there. Thank you so much. Maybe we can talk about it in the Q&A.
Thank you so much, Salomé. Great talk. Then now we continue with Professor Laura Podalsky. She will be sharing with us her talk, Still Moving, Violence, Visual Regimes, and Affect. Thank you, Professor Podalsky, and welcome.
Well, that was fun, Salomé. I look forward to talking more about that. I was laughing the whole time that you were showing that last clip. So it's a pleasure to be here, and I want to thank everybody, and particularly Miguel, for inviting me. What I'm presenting is a version of a longer paper that I gave at a conference on violence, affect, and Latin American cultural production. And that event made me reflect on the usefulness of analyzing Latin American cinema within a larger mediascape and a larger visual regime. So today I'll be discussing that larger audiovisual horizon before offering a brief analysis of Alex Rivera and Cristina Ibarra's 2019 film, The Infiltrators. Yep. The origins of this presentation began with a photograph that was published in the New York Times in June 2019, an overhead shot of a man and a little girl both face down on a riverbank. It's not important to show you the picture, or is it? You'll remember it, or you won't, or you'll remember a similar photograph of some other child face down on some other shore. Shortly after the photo's broad circulation, Philip Kennicott wrote an essay for the Washington Post titled, "We Used to Think Photos Like This Could Change the World." What Kennicott said about the limitations of such photographs is nothing new. Susan Sontag, Gene Franco, and many others have said similar things. For such critics, photographs' ability to make visible and violences and repressions and to generate shock in viewers located elsewhere is insufficient, if not questionable. Soliciting such facile sensorial reactions like pity and compassion don't mobilize viewers who do not already have a disposition to do so. Instead, such photographs crystallize existing hierarchies between the sites of capture and the zones of reception. In other words, between those who take and view such photographs on the one hand, and on the other, the others whose likeness is taken, frozen in time and place by that act. Moreover, according to such critics, any indignation or outrage generated by one photograph dissolves in the mechanical reproduction of the same, yet another dead child face down on yet another riverbank. Of course, such trivializing dynamics are part of other media as well. In analyzing the current representation of Latin American migrants in the US media, my colleagues Ana Puga and Victor Espinosa argue that there is, quote, a political economy of suffering, end quote, that guides or perhaps determines not only the responses of spectators located far away, but also the actions of the migrants themselves. The representational conventions found in US news reports, documentaries, fiction films, and plays, as well as in the public performative actions of migrants themselves, implicitly follow a melodramatic script, a script that demands that immigrants suffer in a visible manner in order for their innocence to be recognized. It is only after that performance of suffering, Puga and Espinosa argue, that the US public acknowledges the immigrants' human rights, or perhaps rights to be human, and their ability to claim citizenship. This melodramatic script isn't the only sensorial framework that guides our reactions to audiovisual representations of violence and its legacies. Mexican scholars Sayak Valencia and Katia Sepúlveda urge us to acknowledge the glamorization of violence in contemporary television series, and more generally, the rise of new media forms and reception practices that produce, or perhaps program, consumer bodies that are captivated by a particular visual regime. Rather than the pleasure associated with the melodramatic mode, Valencia and Sepúlveda identify an even more absorbing sensorial dynamic that instantiates a feedback loop that is difficult to interrupt. The arguments of Valencia, Sepúlveda, Puga and Espinosa, Franco and Sontag are powerful and compelling. And yet still, I ask myself if sensorial appeals always preserve and legitimize existing power structures, dynamics, discourses, and epistemologies. Can contemporary audiovisual media generate something other than shock, pity, and compassion for others? If so, what might be the formal tactics by which those violences might be perceptible otherwise, if not anew? And what are the circuits that amplify such intensities? And how do audiovisual media function within those circuits as relay points? So my first huge section is called, or big section is called, of mediascapes, violences, and time-based media. Before discussing the infiltrator's depiction of DACA activists' ingenious response to the repressive nature of US immigration policy, I want to first situate that film within a larger mediascape in Mexico and the US, and then argue that we need a capacious understanding of violences as registered in audiovisual media. Between 2010 and 2018, the Mexican film industry produced a number of important serious films about violence, and several of these about the situation of Mexican migrants traveling to the US. While those films received a great deal of critical attention, both within and outside of Mexico, Mexican audiences, for their part, generally favored other sorts of films, superhero franchises, sci-fi and fantasy spectacles, family movies, and a few horror films. What you're seeing here is just obviously a snapshot from 2016, but it's quite representative in terms of the top types of box office hits that were popular in Mexico in that kind of 8-year period. I will note that in the same year, the top earners among Mexican-made films were mostly rom-coms, although there was one serious, so-called serious film about the violence of migration at the very end, Desierto, right? The Jonas Cuarón film. During this same period, The results were notably similar in the US. And here again, I'm just giving you a 1 year snapshot again, that year 2016, but we'll see many similarities, right? What are we to make of these statistics and similarities between box office hits in Mexico and the US? Might these tendencies seem to point to a shared desire, shall we say, a shared hunger, to see superheroes with pure hearts, if sometimes questionable ethics, who know how to administer just violence, and perhaps a widely held fascination with prolonged scenes, sequences of violent spectacles showcasing the latest innovations of computer-generated technologies, of city streets and high-rises being decimated by space invaders or greedy human beings, or in other years of dinosaurs killing humans, or of adults encouraging young adults to kill each other. On the small screen in the US and Mexico, so-called quality series like Breaking Bad, La Reina del Sur, and El Señor de los Cielos explore the violent lives of drug traffickers. The bloody events depicted in the series are a world apart from the intergalactic conflicts of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, and yet also feature, as noted by Valencia and Sepúlveda, and I'm quoting here, all powerful hypnotic figures, leaders, clans, groups, and forces who defy and destabilize the order of things in an ongoing call for destruction in order to claim power and legitimacy, end quote. Admittedly, this comparison is a bit overwrought. Yet the box office hits about superheroes and popular television series about drug lords are part of the same audiovisual economy, or in Martin Jay's terms, the same scopic regime that frames and perhaps determines the perceptible. One that, at least according to Valencia and Sepúlveda, constantly bombards the, quote, consumer body to keep it permanently in a pre-reflexive state and to mentally predispose audiences to incorporate violence as an everyday and indispensable part of the governability of the world, end quote. Whether or not we agree with Valencia and Sepúlveda's analysis of the new cultura live, it is worth asking what happens to a photograph of a girl and a man, perhaps her father, face down in a river within this context. Is its sentimental appeal of what we take to be an innocent child whose father was unable to protect her on their migrant journey for a better life, neutralized or at least temporarily fixed to a momentary clutching of the pearls until the New York Times reader turns to the next page, or more likely clicks open another window? In pulling together these disparate audiovisual products, I'm not trying to paint the mediascape with too broad of a brushstroke. As I'll argue in a moment, I think recognizing and analyzing the formal tactics deployed within specific media forms, as well as in with particular texts, is absolutely crucial. But first, we have to acknowledge that audiences experience the mediascape as a whole, in which multiple forms of violence are on display. The contemporary Mexican and US mediascapes comment on drug trafficking, domestic violence and bullying, migration, and the violence of state repression, among many other things. At times, the connection between these violences is obvious, but many times, for very pragmatic and understandable reasons, media scholars examine the representation of a single form. From my perspective, it's useful to remember that all of these violences are experienced together in everyday life and everyday experience. Of course, to different degrees and proximities or level of immediacy. The representation of one sort of violence carries the imprint of other violences and their representation in terms of the experience of audiences. Sorry about that. Zoom life, right? Equally important is the need to recognize the rhythms and temporalities of these violences. I'm thinking here of the work of Rob Nixon and his notion of slow violence. At first glance, he seems to be pointing towards structural violence and their long histories. However, what draws me to Nixon's concept is its emphasis on the duration of such violences and how certain works, in his case, its literary works, manage to capture and communicate not only the collective and temporal scale of structural violence, but also their accumulated weight and legacies for subjects, societies, and environments. This approach seems to be particularly important when analyzing time-based media, such as film, television, and performance, and to some degree, photography as well. As noted by film scholar Juan Llamas Rodriguez, one can speak not only of slow cinema, but also of a cinema of slow violence. What role does duration play in the encounter between bodies made possible through the process of watching a film, television program, or performance? Can a film like Ellie on the everyday repercussions of the drug trade, with its scenes of terrific, terrible violence, produce something other than shock? Can it use film's formal tactics to generate a dense corporal recognition of violence and its aftermaths? In other words, of what enduring violence is and feels like, and also what it means, as Llamas Rodriguez and Nilo Coret have argued. Even if photographs capture a single brief moment, doesn't that medium have formal devices that encourage us to recognize a before and an after? And sometimes every now and then to make us register the duration of that violence on a sensorial level, even if its causes remain outside the frame. In this last part of my presentation, I want to anchor these overarching comments to a brief targeted analysis of the infiltrators, about the actions of DACA activists who infiltrated the Broward County Detention Center in Florida to help the undocumented men and women who were imprisoned there to advocate more effectively for their release, and more generally to interrupt and interrogate Obama-era immigration policies and practices. The film could be categorized as a documentary, but given the important role of reenactments, it's really more useful to think of The Infiltrator as a docudrama. Indeed, director Rivera and Ibarra have, from their very first shorts, long shared an ability to cannily rework generic formulas and modes towards social critique. In the case of The Infiltrators, Ibarra and Rivera draw on the strategies of the suspense film and more particularly the heist film, with the goal of encouraging spectators to recognize in an embodied way the constant menace of surveillance, the ongoing fear of family separations, and most particularly, the urgency of timely action. In some ways, The Infiltrators' formal strategies are similar to those employed in other audiovisual projects that encourage spectators to align themselves, often in sensorially laden ways, with undocumented people. And we could think of this not only in terms of serious documentaries such as Purgatorio, or thrillers like Jonás Cuarón's Desierto, but also Alejandro González Iñárritu's recent multimedia installation, Carne y Arena. All of these projects labor to individualize and humanize undocumented peoples, to feel anger toward those who victimize them or attempt to do so, and frame the struggles depicted in terms of what is just and unjust in ways that exceed strictly legal frameworks. However, unlike those works, The Infiltrator situates undocumented people from beginning to end as agents rather than victims, and encourages spectators to feel called to timely action. The film does this in part by framing the actions of the DACA activists as a type of heist, with the imprisoned undocumented people as the treasure that is going to be taken by activist thieves whose motives are justified. Indeed, Ibarra and Rivera themselves characterize their film as the, quote, Ocean's 11 of immigration. It's a great quote. The film opens with Marco, who you can see in the upper right-hand corner, one of the protagonists saying in voiceover, everyone needs a plan. A phrase he repeats throughout the film as we see Marco, Mohammed, and Viri, or the team, explain and carry out their well-coordinated plan. The plot is organized around a series of suspenseful questions. Will Marco and later Biri be able to infiltrate the facility? Once inside, will they be able to avoid detection? And of course, will they be able, with the help of a growing group of co-conspirators, to get the human treasure out in time, in other words, before deportation? Even as The Infiltrators walks the viewer through the complexities of immigration policy and law, the film makes sensorial appeals. For example, the film makes viewers aware of the ongoing weight of being surveilled. That is, of knowing that one is always potentially the object of a detecting eye and that detections have consequences through the frequent use of deep space, shallow focus compositions. While this might be understandable as most scenes are set in the detention center, the ever-present scrutiny of prison guards stands in for and makes perceptible more generalized forms of surveillance as experienced by immigrants outside the prison walls in their everyday lives. And by aligning us with Marco and his team inside the prison, we are encouraged to tense up and remain attentive at all times, aware of the surroundings and the dangers that it holds for us. And in certain scenes, the film notes, in this case through rack focus, how this form of low-grade stress can rapidly escalate towards more explicit acts of violence. The other main sensorial appeal made by Ibarra and Rivera's film also emerges within the framework of the heist film. Will the team be able to get the undocumented prisoners like Benny out in time before they're deported? In Benny's case, the film crosscuts between scenes of him hearing the news of his impending deportation, of Mohammed outside the prison mobilizing the activist network, of Marco strategizing with Benny inside the detention center about what to do once Benny's at the airport, and we see there in the bottom right, a guard hovering in the background. And another scene of Benny getting out of the van at the foot of the stairs to board the plane. In this and other scenes, the film underscores the importance of timely action. So what are we to make of the infiltrators' sensorial tactics? Do the filmmakers' formal choices align with the tactics of the DACA activists themselves, who cannily time their interventions with lawmakers and their media campaigns for maximum impact? Might the film's form help make forms of slow violence experienced by undocumented peoples in the United States perceptible to non-immigrant viewers, all the while insisting that the undocumented are agents and not victims? We're not merely victims. Might the film encourage us of the urgency of acting in a timely fashion and mobilize viewers beyond the end of the film? Perhaps, perhaps not. The Infiltrators is now available on YouTube as well as the filmmaker's website. So it has the potential to circulate widely. I certainly encourage you to watch the film. So perhaps we'll see what happens next. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Podalsky. It's been great. We count with the Infiltrators last year in our film festival. We have a wonderful conversation with Viridiana, and one of the producers, Alex, and couldn't join us because they have a new baby and they were moving. And without any other remarks, wonderful conversation following up. We have Manuel Sánchez Cabrera, joining us from UNC Chapel Hill at the battle on representation, non-places, and the coloniality of being in three films about Central American migration. Very timely connected with Professor Pobos. Manuel, bienvenido.
Thank you very much, Miguel, and thank you very much to all the audience and the participants in the presentation. I am so thankful for this opportunity. And at the same time, I would say, I feel the pressure. It was a fantastic presentation by the previous presenters, and I hope I can make it work. I am going to show an image just as an illustration, but I'm not going to change this one. And at the end of my presentation, I will show a small clip from La Jaula de Oro that hopefully will show my arguments in my presentation. This is a working paper. Still, it's a very, very rough idea that I hope I will improve eventually. Central American migration to the United States is apparently more visible than ever before. Just in case, I have been changing the name of this paper for a while, so I'm still, this is tentative if you see a different name here. There is an enormous amount of visual images in the US media circulating about the Central American exodus, portraying the misery, the poverty, and the desperation of Central Americans. In most of those images, Central American migrants are constructed and or represented in two contradictory ways, as helpless victims and as dangerous others. Cinema has responded to the Central American migrant experience, at times offering an alternative to the media representation of Central Americans. And I'm doing this, I'm trying to to analyze this film from a Central American perspective. With this, I mean that I grew up in Central America, and I'm thinking my work through the lenses of what Central America means to me, like someone that grew up and was raised in the region. So even if I'm diasporic now, have been here for 7 years, I'm still thinking through Central America. In the last decade, films such as Sin Nombre, La Vida Precoz y Breve de Sabina Rivas en La Jaula de Oro have tried to offer a more insightful, more nuanced, or simply a more real representation of Central American migrants and their odyssey. They offer a kind of visual ethnography of Central Americans and the migratory path across Mexico. I aim to explore in this presentation a representation pattern in these films. First, Sin Nombre, Sabina Rivas en La Jaula de Oro aim to represent the colonial condition of Central Americans, putting them in some ways as the rage of the earth, in fan nonsense, of course. On the other hand, they prominently portray what I will call the non-places of coloniality, which can be understood as those spaces of transience, those crossroads of human relations where human beings remain anonymous, not by the logic of modernity, like Mar Auge suggested in his work, but by the logic of coloniality. And here is very important to think about this in terms of like what modernity has offered in globalization in terms of the non-places, which are, for example, the airports, the stations, many other places. And in contrast, the non-places of coloniality, and hopefully this will be clear eventually, is are the frontiers, the migratory paths, for example, the brothels in the southern borders, or the train stations where migrants wait for the trains. The most important question that this presentation tries to answer is, why does this pattern of representation exist? What is it saying about Central American migration? Or in this case, what are the films actually saying about Central American migration? Based on Stuart Hall's notion on representation, I argue that by emphasizing these two aspects, the human colonial condition of Central Americans and the non-places of coloniality, these films aim to come out with a definition of what the migrant experience is for Central Americans. In so doing, they reinforce in a different way the idea that Central Americans are mere victims of a terrible destiny and dangerous because of it. So one of the ideas I have is that if you think about Central American migration, those ideas, those two terms together, Central American as a signifier of cultural difference or as something that points out to Central Americans in themselves, I'm sorry for this, and migration as a social event, both together are constantly displaced towards negative connotations such as violence, death, garbage, victimage, and danger. So if you think about Central American migration together, both of them together, Central American and migration together, there seems to be this idea of violence, this seems to be this idea of garbage attached to the terms. So I aim to explore the practices of representation about Central American migration. The three films portray the Central American migrant experience through the perspective of young people without a future. People who, instead of migrating, are fleeing the region, as Salvadoran journalist Oscar Martinez puts it in his well-known book, Los Migrantes Que No Importan. In fact, according to a Christian Science Monitor article, Central America might be considered the deadliest non-war zone in the world. Nonetheless, the films do not give much attention to Central America in itself. And this is a pattern to the migration genre films. They do not pay attention to what happened in Central America. they just focus in the migratory experience in Mexico. Instant, like many other stories on Central American migration, they emphasize the ways in which Mexico determines a before and after for many Central Americans that attend the journey. It is prominent, for example, the way in which the films portray how many Central Americans travel thousands of miles on top of the dangerous freight train called La Bestia, or how rape is a common violence women are subjected to. According to Amnesty International, the passage through Mexico is one of the most dangerous in the world. Thus, the film shows how rape es el pan de cada día, en la migración es un mundo de sálvese quien pueda. They show the audience how hard, or the viewer, how hard and difficult the journey is. So that's the main point, I think, of the migration genre in these three films, at least. They want to show you how difficult the path is. The films produce a representation of Central Americans that claims to be based in reality. However, they are fabrications, and more importantly, they are, if seen at least from a Central American perspective, as I am doing it, external fabricated depictions of Central Americans. With this, I mean that in these discourses, in this representation, Central Americans' perspectives, I would say, have been always or have been marginalized by the metropolis and by other subaltern groups like Mexico. So it's more like Central American migration has been represented from an outside perspective. The word representation has been mostly understood as a reflection or a distortion of reality. This is because on the one hand, the term has been commonly defined as presenting or depicting something or someone else. The word carries the notion that the thing or the person depicted or presented was already there. Representation is also defined as the notion of standing for or taking the place of something or someone else. I'm taking this idea of representation from Stuart Hall. He says that both of these ideas are brought together in the notion of representation, and within it, the idea of giving meaning to things, topics, types of people, events, and in this case, the films are giving meaning to migration or Central American migration. So traditionally, representation is the way, has been understood as the way in which meaning is somehow given to the things depicted through, for example, films, right? Stuart Hall points out that if one thinks that the meaning that is given is very different from or is a kind of distortion of what really is, then one's work on representation will be measuring the gap between what one might think is the true meaning of an event or an object and how it is presented in the media, and in this case, in the films, right? But I don't want to see the representation of Central Americans in these films in questions of how authentic or distorted they are. It's not about that. More important, I think, not to focus on if they are authentic or if they are distortions of reality. That's actually, I would say, not as important as I hope to show the idea that I want to share. Instead, I see the process of representation in these films as constitutive of the event itself, migration. And I'm also taking this idea from Stuart Hall notion on representation. Representation enters into the constitution of the object in discussion. It is part of the object itself. It is constitutive of it. It is one of its conditions of existence. And therefore, representation is not outside the event, not after the event, but within the event itself. In a way, as Hall suggests, an event doesn't exist meaningfully until it has been represented. So much of what the Central American migration means, or what the Central American migration is, and how the event in itself, if represented, is represented in films, therefore depend on the practices of representation, but they by any means represent reality. So it's the choices, in this case of the filmmakers, the choices of the films in themselves, what do they want to represent and what their ideas, the ideas they bring with them before representation. The films from the very beginning established something akin to the life of the colonized in Fanon's sense. A tracking shot backwards introduces Juan walking in a world without spaciousness in a jaula de oro, a shanty town, a poor and overpopulated settlement made of cardboard, scrap metal, and wood. And I'm sorry, my baby, my 2 months baby is crying and it's getting crazy right now. A few minutes later, an establishing shot shows an enormous garbage dump. This is Juan's world, a crashing place, a hungry town. It is a world of future migrants. So the film, La Jaula de Oro, in this case, it is putting at the very beginning that meaning for Central American migration. Franz Fanon describes the colonized world as a place of ill fame, inhabited by people of evil repute. Sin Nombre, for example, is dedicated to introduce, like a documentary, the underworld of Mara la Salvatrucha. The audience is saturated with objects depicting death, such as crucifixes, rosary beds, pendants, chants, graffitis on the wall, and even rest in peace tattoos. Gang members, as an image of the colonized, are born there and will die there. It doesn't matter where or how. As Fanon says, the colonized world is a world without spaciousness. People live there on top of each other and their huts are built one on top of each other. Sabina Rivas, on the other hand, reveals that the colonized world finds his freedom through violence. The first shot shows the sunrise and many undistinguished gang members walking in the horizon. They walk towards the camera, showing the marks of their belongings. They are in a river bank, ready for what happens to be a ritual of initiation. The leader shouts and explains that they will never support someone who doesn't belong to their gang, but in order to get into it, fearlessness has to be demonstrated and violence is the means to do it. Here, violence is a cleansing for. It frees gang members like the colonized people in Fanon's sense from an inferiority complex. It makes them fearless and restores their self-respect. The films portray from the very beginning this colonial condition. The viewer sees that this is an undeveloped in human world. And more specifically, the migration genre seems to be a cinematic version of the coloniality of being. The coloniality of being makes reference to the life experiences of the colonized. According to Walter Mignolo, the coloniality of being is the product of the combination between the coloniality of power, the interrelation among modern forms of exploitation and domination, and the coloniality of knowledge, colonization's impact on the different areas of knowledge production. The coloniality of being then indicates those aspects that create exceptions of what life is worth caring and those that are dispensable, whose populations deserve to live and those that are not going to make it into the future. It creates a non-human, or rather an inhuman war. And we see this in the films all the time. For example, in the opening shot in Sin Nombre, we see the image of a forest in which the camera zooms into a path that guides our gaze to a future, or the viewer's gaze to a future full of promise. However, as the camera pans out, we soon realize that we are actually looking at a picture in a wall through Willis Eyes, which is the protagonist, is the gang member, also known as Casper in the film. His nickname, Casper, makes reference to the popular animated character Casper, the friendly ghost, suggesting his phantasmagoric existence. Sin Nombre, the naming itself, indicates, right, that phantasmagoric existence, suggests that he is an invisible entity, a condemned, a being who is not there. And the same happens in La Jaula de Oro and Sabina Riva. Olivia Consentino points out that the spectral allows Sabina Rivas in La Jaula de Oro to nuance the seen and unseen processes of violence that Central American female migrants' bodies experience and the reactionary performances those bodies enact to counter that violence. They juxtapose the invisible with the visible, presence with absence. The coloniality of being marks a being as a non-being. And the films portray this in the protagonists. They are kind of a sort of invisible entity. And what is invisible about them is actually their very humanity. And we have many examples throughout the films about this. But invisibility and dehumanization are still insufficient in these films. They still need more to indicate the colonial condition of Central Americans. They also persistently use the notion of garbage as another of his motifs. In Sin Nombre, Willie, the protagonist, is in a place that seems to be the Gans house, and is located at the center of the frame. The old furniture and the table full of leftovers and garbage amplify the dominant mood of the film and stress a trashy, and I put it here, existence. A glass of orange juice, Casper's yellow cross in his rosary, and dull yellow walls indicate decay in sickness. On a screen, there are several yellow objects such as umbrellas, old baseball caps, curtains, flowers, a baby pajamas, bags, plantains, graffitis, t-shirts, lamps, sweaters, robes, and even law enforcement tapes. And this is not exclusive of the missing scene. I mean, the films in itself put garbage as, and the same happens in La Jaula de Oro at the very beginning with the shantytown. There is a person, a transvestite, selling flowers at La Bombilla station in Sin Nombre. She wears yellow and carries a yellow bag, emphasizing in some ways her trashy and tragic existence at the margins. Thus, a yellow tonality on a screen gives us a sense of frustration, repugnance, hopelessness, and desolation. But this is not the only physical trashy existing. It is also internalized, subjected aspect. It is an internalized subjective aspect in the characters. Anthropologist Robin Nagel argues that garbage is quite highly visible and constant and invisibilized. Every single thing you see is future trash. Everything you saw, everything. So we are surrounded by ephemera, but we cannot acknowledge that because it's a kind of scary. It's kind of scary because ultimately it points to our own temporariness. Trash is not merely useless, worthless, or a discarded matter. It can also indicate something, and I quote Arturo Arias and Claudio Milian, something akin to a devalued short life existence. And the films portray this aspect of devaluation, of the trashy existence of Central American migrants in Mexico when they are trying to cross Mexico. For example, there is a scene in Sabina Rivas in which Sabina is caught by the border authorities in his crossing from Guatemala to Mexico. She's with a, as you can see in the image, with a Mexican passport. It's a full passport. But the policeman, the migration policeman, says, "You are not Mexican. You are a Honduran. I can smell it." So like garbage, he smells Sabina. And in Sin Nombre, there is also another sequence in which you see that Central Americans are associated with garbage. There is another important aspect, and I want to conclude with this, that the films, that the representation of the colonial condition of Central America in these films go alongside a specific representation of the places they seem to inhabit, and more precisely, those they transit through. And these ones are the ones I call the non-places of coloniality, because you see that modernity, as Mignolo and Quijano says, has the other side, the coloniality. And there are non-places of coloniality. And here we have the brothel, we have the train actually in itself is a non-place of coloniality, because migrants are represented as if they were commodities. And I want to finish with this idea, because the films and the representation of Central Americans try to fix what the migrant experience is, or what it means. They say that Central Americans live in hell. The viewer needs to have empathy for them, because there is nothing better to tell about them. The migration genre reveals that what is important is to show that precarious and violent war. There seems to be no other way of representing it. Central American migration is becoming a political, historical, and social discourse that operates like a language, like a sliding signifier, in which it signifies, or his signifiers reference, not reality in itself, migration, but the systems of meaning that had come to be fixed about migration. And here I want to point out what Professor Podalsky quote when she was saying a political economy of suffering, right? It is like in order to represent migration and Central Americans in relation with migration, we need to emphasize this aspect, because this is what sells this suffering, right? This violence. In this sense, Central American migrants and their journey through Mexico came to be defined as victims in danger, because there is a regime of truth in Foucault's sense that says, had established what is true about Central Americans. Therefore, the representation of Central American migration is in a vicious circle in which it only has value if it is associated with images of inhumanity, desperation, violence, and death. And the problem with this is that we might lose sight of other forms of visual representation that might help us understand the motivations, decisions, and agency of Central Americans and why they migrate in the first place. And here I have, for example, a documentary from El Salvador that is called María en Tierra de Nadie, that focuses on the experiences and what the migrants have to say about their own experiences. And I would like to finish, if I'm able to do it. Miguel, let me know, please.
Thank you, yes. We are over the time.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, no, we can invite everybody now. I'm going to, sorry for our panelists, for the second panel, Indigenous, Afro, and Older Cinemas in Latin America. We'll take 5 minutes from your panel to go over some important issues that Professor Podalsky, Professor Salomé, and Manuel brought to us. And those are the issues of indeed representation that is at the center of what we do, right? Issues of representation that have been theorized in many ways and forms, but that at the end they try to bring the issue of subjectivity, right? Of who has been or it is represented. It can be issues of labor, processes of labor, and aesthetics connected to that, or the origins of anthropological or ethnographic films are, you know, right there on that whole genre and ways of representing, but also the issues of existence, right, and agency, as Manuel and Professor Podalsky were telling us. I remember before dying, Susan Sontag wrote her own response to her book on photography. And I think Laura was talking about that in the background, was the whole thing there, right? Representing the pain of others, right? Images cannot really do that, even if we theorize that it can, right? That is our only way to try to share those experiences, but that at the end, they are not possible to be shared. And in a sense, Manuel's bringing that with the issue of existence through representation and Stuart Hall's work. Then just a brief comment about that, There is an amazing question by Sam Honeycutt. Thank you, Sam. Salomé will be answering to you by writing. Amazing, very poignant question of a marvelous book that we are reading, as you see, is now that we've been using as the books produced by Professor Podalsky and many others that are coming. Anyone wants to comment on that? We have a few minutes. In subjectivity, and I think in The Infiltrators, the whole thing is about subjectivity, and it's playing this double role, right? Using the real subjects and then reenactments, yeah. Right? And right then it's the issue of who is represented here, how is this happening, why is showing that in front of us, right? Revealing the whole secrets in a hyper-reflexive film, right? Documentary film that is hyper-reflexive, not film, not fiction, not what is going on there.
I agree. I actually have a question for Manuel. Have you seen este El Camino, the Ishtar Yassin? Where you would place it in your spectrum?
I actually have been doing a lot of work on fiction films and documentaries, but I haven't had the opportunity to watch El Camino. I know there is a pattern in documentaries and fiction films that represent Central Americans this way. And I'm interested to uncover, to think about it, because it's kind of problematic. It's some meanings that that seems to define what is to be Central American after the experience.
Or I'd be interested because she's from Costa Rican, she's a Costa Rican, of Costa Rican heritage. So I'm mm-hmm. interested, I would be interested in seeing what your thoughts, and it's not migrating to the US, it's migrating between Costa Rica and Nicaragua. And so I haven't seen it in many years, it was a film that came to mind when you were talking.
Thank you actually for the clarification. Actually, I have known the film, but I haven't been able to get it. Actually, there was a professor in Costa Rica, Maria Lourdes Cortez, that I'm still waiting for her to send me that film.
We are looking for a copy to work with it. I know.
Yeah. And I think it is a different representation of the Central American migration because this is an internal migration. I'm more interested in seeing these representations in relation to the United States in some way in migration. So if you think Central American migration is also being thought as migration to the US, there is never talks about migration to Europe, for example, or to other places within Central America, which is something different than what you can see in nonfiction narratives, for example, in nonfiction literature. For example, the work of El Faro, they actually talk about a lot of migration within Central America, Salvadorians moving to Belize, Nicaraguans moving to Costa Rica. So it is in some ways from Central America, migration is thought differently. The dominance of the US media and the dominance of the conversation about US Central American migration to the US overshadowed, I think I can say that, other conversations on migration. So I want to kind of disrupt what we think about Central Americans and the images of them in the media.
And I think that connects with El Velador and your discussion about El Velador. It would be like coming out of your discussion of Velador within the process, General Salomé, because there is also issues of representation and non-representation there, right? Is it in the making of a mausoleum, a city of dead, and you there is so much representation, so much subjectivity, so much vivid archaeology, right? That brings all sorts of other dimensions also to discuss about this issue of migration and bordering spaces, dead and alive, north and south, all sorts of things.
Yes.
Yeah, I want you to go over because you have a great conversation and we'll be watching the film on Wednesday.
I have a quick question. It's slightly in a different direction. And it's for Laura, and that is, I sort of wonder, you know, as I was listening, you started with the Julia LeDuc image, and this question that always, you know, it's sort of constant, this problem of the mobilization of viewers after the film or after the media. So like on the one hand, I love this idea of the kind of expanded media landscape, but as you were talking about the Julia LeDuc and the possibility of mobilization, I was thinking about the comparative case of the videos and films of police brutality, like the George Floyd film. So I sort of wondered, you know, why is it that I would never say of that video that it didn't change the world, or, you know, or the Rodney King video, or, you know, this series of videos. So we have this kind of comparative case, but why is it the case that those videos are having a kind of impact? They're not only changing the discourse, they're getting people out into the street. And at the same time that I say that, there's that like parallel discourse about the, you know, representation, the abjection, the representation of Black bodies. Should we look at the video? Should we not look at the videos? But they seem like these kind of parallel cases. So I just wonder if, you know.
It's a great and difficult question. I don't know. I'm also struck by, this isn't quite answering your question, but John Beasley Murray and Freya Shiwi have written, I thought, powerfully about what are the affects that mobilize, not just the objects, but the affects that mobilize, and what role can outrage play? And their argument is sort of like outrage is not enough, right? It has to be something else. But the cases that you've just brought up do generate that outrage, right? So I don't know, but those are great examples.
One thing that occurred to me on the comparing the Julia LeDuc to the audio of the detention, inside the detention centers, the audio of the children crying and the way that that had a kind of mobilizing function. But the thing that struck me is maybe the difference between the LeDuc image is one, I think you're right to kind of frame it in terms of the melodramatic, but in the case of something like the kids in the detention center or George Floyd, like it has a kind of evidentiary function that contradicts a certain ideological narrative advanced by the state. So whenever this kind of evidence contradicts that, seems like it's not just that it's outrageous, it's that it's like, wait, that's not supposed to happen. What's going on? That's not what they say their function is. What's going on?
Yeah, but I mean, I think my own take is a little bit about crying children. And I think the audio is different than visual stuff, but I think it still appeals to us on a sentimental plane. It's children, right? I don't know. I think these are, I mean, I'm also just very interested about duration and how media forms, and I really haven't thought about like radio or simply audio forms, but how visual forms, and it's also, I mean, this is where Valencia and her whole notion of capitalismo agora, right? There's a functionality of certain horrific visualizations. They can be in real life, they can be bodies beheaded in the streets, or they can be on screen. But there's something about the speed of how many images that we see and, you know, what that means. And I think she's coming from that, but I don't think all time-based media function the same way, right? And it's kind of teasing that out. And it's a really, I guess, messy response, but I think there are many prongs that we could explore.
Yes, I mean, this conversation could go on and on. We have an important question by Professor Florence Babb, one of our professors of anthropology working on issues of feminisms, global feminisms, Latin American feminisms, decolonial feminisms, about Diane Cristal. And I think this is to Laura. I think this will take us, way in a larger conversation. It would be great if you can just give her a note through the Q&A, and we'll have some time before the two sessions of today end to reflect a little bit on what we've heard. But we have the panel Indigenous, Afro, and Other Cinemas coming up, and we don't want to eat that much time because we have a very tight schedule today. Thank you so, so much. I'm so sorry. We took some very valuable minutes at the beginning of this, but the conversation is open. This is just the first of several during these 2 days. We really appreciate your participation and have you here make a lot of difference to the work we all do. Thank you so much. Now, without any other remarks, we'll invite Amalia Cordova, the Latino Digital Curator for the Smithsonian Center for Folklife and Cultural Heritage, to share her talk, Emerging Landscapes of Indigenous Festivals. Amalia, it's great to have you here. Otra vez, un gran abrazo y bueno, empezamos contigo.
Mari po lamien po kompuche. I would like confirmation that you're seeing my screen.
We are Mari.
Mari. Okay. Manyum. So inche Amalia Cordova. Hi, my name is Amalia Cordova, and I am here in Washington, D.C., which is a traditional territory of the Piscataway Nation. And I want to acknowledge that this is their territory on which they maintain relations and to present day, and also that's a territory of great impact of slave economy. So there's a lot of multi-generation Native DC folks who are not native to here, but have made this their home. So I'm at the Smithsonian Institution at the Center for Folklife and Cultural Heritage. And there I am a Latino digital curator of new and emerging media, which didn't exist there before. So I've kind of had to figure that out. In today's presentation, as always, I would love to thank Miguel Rojas-Sotelo for the invitation, all the other panelists. And I'm always in dialogue with people who nurture the work, and I'm kind of a participant observer. So Elizabeth Weatherford, Angelo Baca, David Hernandez Palmar, Francisco Buchaqueo, and Janet Payan, and all the filmmakers across Avellala make this work possible. My job is as a curator. So I'm going to begin a little bit by talking about curating Indigenous cinemas and how we decide and define what that corpus actually is. So I'm glad to have this retrospective framework, because since the 1980s, when Indigenous communities in the Americas, or Avellala, began producing audiovisual media that's come to be known as Indigenous media, great forces have continued to impact Indigenous communities in life ways. Economically extractive megaprojects are always striving to feed this insatiable global demand for raw materials and cheap labor that threaten Indigenous territory on a daily basis. So on this front, legal battles are fought and some are won, but all these attempts and their triumphs are often buried in the strides of global corporate media and its communication networks that promote consumption and aspirations of a very cosmopolitan, deterritorialized existence. So as this reach of this media grows more extensive and intrusive than ever, Indigenous people are actively harnessing these powerful tools to put them to use in their own communities and at the service of their own struggles. But as these Indigenous filmmakers grapple with this uneven digital landscape and gain presence and visibility at international film festivals and academic events, such as this one, some basic questions regarding their actual ability to engage with and study this corpus still remain outside the scope of cultural policy across Latin America, and even engaged in specialized scholarly inquiry. So some of my questions beyond like what makes a work Indigenous, which we'll talk about, is again, how the Indigenous filmmakers themselves find support, how do they gain professional development, how do they connect to their peers and reach new audiences when they are amongst the most disenfranchised and remote communities in the Americas. I'm also concerned right now about what becomes of the footage that is accumulated in production by either Indigenous or non-Indigenous projects and communities. Who controls the final works? And are these being cataloged, stored, or made accessible to community members and potentially to educators and researchers such as all of you? And where is the filmography and the historical memory of this important social movement from its beginnings and as a cultural expression? My research, as well as my curatorial practice, has dealt with how the combined and often transnational network of filmmakers, organizations, and film festivals are articulating, strengthening, and shaping the production and circulation of indigenous media across Avialala. In the industrial film world, these networks are called circuits, but in the landscape of indigenous media practice, these outlets are part of a greater process of a tejido, which is a Spanish language term that refers to weavings, but that also invokes the act of interlacing. And indigenous methodologies have contributed to strengthening the support for indigenous film and video circulation. So in Latin America, the definitions of what constitutes indigenous video are still debated. And the discussion has moved beyond the desire to categorize and settle on conventions. And there have overflowed from these specialized circuits. And the question itself provokes thoughtful reflections on difference, authenticity, activism, as we've spoken about, the role of media, and a variety of subtopics. And that often touches upon what kind of world we want to live in. At their best, whenever these discussions take place, a new space is created, an unsettling, often intercultural space that contributes to the recognition of indigenous, contemporary, and historical perspectives, offering an indigenous framework of knowledge and resistance. What we're seeing on screen here is the definition that CLACPI has given a while back in 2009 on what they consider indigenous video or indigenous film to be. And as you can see from my highlighted the emphasis, it includes the works, their directors and filmmakers. So it's not just a filmography, it's not just the corpus, but the process and the community around that. And that within that corpus, there be a worthy vision, a worthy representation of the knowledge, culture, projects, claims, achievements, and struggles of indigenous peoples. So it's relational and it's participatory, and it crosses the line of on and off screen. So while we have this really stunningly far-flung community of production happening across the whole continent, it's actually at the granular level that the collectives of indigenous media in Latin America play a role in combating discrimination, advocating for indigenous rights, and they become the producers themselves, become their own cultural brokers while trying to stay grounded in their community realities and being held always to local accountability. The hybrid and often multivocal nature of videos produced through workshops, community consultation, and traditions of reciprocity continue to defy mainstream aesthetics. As media scholar Robert Stamm has called it, he's included indigenous media under subversive aesthetics that he has. And also they defy categorizations of the film industry, such as the collective production of films that don't necessarily have a single director or that are produced by the collective in general. So that affects more than the aesthetics. It also affects the production schedules, the availability, and the packaging of how these works end up circulating in the broader world. And that means that for the most part, all the cinema of Avialala continues to be largely absent from national cinemas and from the commercial circuits. And that's because there's a divergent ethos, basically. So unlike commercial media, indigenous media production takes into account the whole process. And it's a part of a continuum of representations from these communities. It's kind of a filmography that sediments different views on a community to counter, of course, foundational narratives and stereotyping. And that makes it difficult to export across borders to big festivals. So that's why it's so important to have our own indigenous film festivals. And who produces the work? I've got this kind of 5-point breakdown of where the work basically comes from. And it comes from both political contexts of indigenous organizations that have communication offices. It can come from nonprofits that engage specifically in media training for indigenous communities, for and with, and indigenous collectives and producers themselves, from academic training programs, even if they are remote. Programs like Ambulante Más Allá have reached indigenous communities and produced professional development opportunities for indigenous filmmakers, kind of new generation of filmmakers that are now going to school, the film school. And we have very, very bottom of the list, state arts and cultural funds, which are very rare. They rarely support indigenous video for pretty obvious reasons. But what I really want to get to is to talk about, and this is basically my focus, the focus of my work has been around the spaces of circulation of indigenous media. And that's where we have a lovely history here of the emergence of the foundational indigenous film festivals. So I'm trying to uncover and highlight how these festivals are actually making contributions to critical thinking around indigeneity, how they're actively countering national and these foundational narratives around Indigenous peoples wherever they are, and how they're convening audiences to better inform themselves and participate in an Indigenous space. So just like the films often have, the line is crossed between on-screen and off-screen, at the festivals, there's kind of like very tiny separation between who's on stage and who's not. These Indigenous film festivals, such as the early ones from 1985, like the Klakpi Festival, are also produce access to training and production, and they're open to showing more experimental works, works that aren't as polished and finished perhaps. And they become spaces of growth, of professional exchange. They develop specific modes of audience outreach, and sometimes they even contribute to the process of preservation of certain films, or they establish collections and archives that in turn become the historical memory of this movement. So the cultural policy, like you saw on the screen before, is very limited. There's very little state funding or cultural arts funding that ends up there. It's a very different landscape from what we can see in Australia, Canada, and New Zealand. And I would say the funding and structure in the United States is not that great either for Indigenous filmmaking. We have the Native Forum at Sundance and other initiatives that are coming up, like the Fourth World Media Lab, but it's very, very limited. So the training that filmmakers get mean that the access to what, you know, the breadth of the work that they can see is rather limited. So a film festival represents a really unique opportunity to sit down and watch immersively in dialogue with Indigenous producers and watch, see the work as it's kind of unfolding. So this lack of there's not like a solidified network, I would say, that we're watching an emergence of film festival networks on a regional level. And it used to be that the film festivals were itinerant. The Klakpi Festival here at the top began in Mexico City, but it travels around every 2 or 3 years. And how the frequency also depends on how the funding structure works, which is why funders are very important. And curiously, Indigenous film festivals in Latin America in the early period were mostly funded by foreign development money agencies that, you know, provided aid money and sometimes in-kind assistance, such as training workshops in Cuba on behalf of the Film School of Cuba. And now I think we're seeing a real important transition into streaming and broadcasting, where we're starting to see, because of the pandemic actually, a turn towards putting all these festivals online and therefore convening people who have more limited access to travel. There may be still digital divides, but people who couldn't travel maybe have more access to seeing the works now. So I'm gonna do a little case study in a bit. And I want you to notice here that the distributors that I identify are all based in the United States or US, Mexico, because very few distributors in Latin America have taken an interest in distributing this work, which is non-commercial. So that means that the actual artists, filmmakers, and collectives and the festivals actually become the point of information to anybody looking for the work. And that was the question that I used to get the most as I was working in Indigenous video in New York. So we have these early festivals that began in the 80s. And then we have the emergence of more global Indigenous film festivals, such as Imaginative, founded in 2001. But there is still a language divide and not dedicated outreach. There's not quite a dialogue between that kind of A-list Berlinale film festival circuit that has now an Indigenous film stand at the Berlinale and these other hemispheric or Latin American regional festivals. And increasingly we're seeing localized festivals that are now starting to become annual. So the rhythm is growing. The amount of work available is also increasing. So what I've done here on my main page is show you a few of the festivals. And one of the values also of the festival, incredible value, is the fact that they're cataloging, they're describing the works, they're collecting the works. So I think one important turning point in my research was when I realized that, you know, I wasn't going to find the work in cinematheques and national film boards. I was going to have to go to the archives of the festivals to trace and track down films I was interested in. So these festivals are decentralized, rotational, or itinerant as they begin and bypass established mainstream media circuits. And they strive to reach underserved communities, both rural and urban. And this itinerancy reflects a profound drive to democratize the opportunities that festivals would offer and not kind of sequester them into one single city. And again, one important factor of the festivals has been the collection of the actual works. Very few festivals actually keep copies of the work. And now that it's digital, even less. So what we have is kind of a fractured audiovisual memory now of the emergence of indigenous video, that a few of the festivals, the Tlacpi Festival has an archive in Bolivia, the Smithsonian National Museum of the American Indians study collection is now at New York University, and there are fractured collections that the institutions or organizations themselves have kept, such as Centers for Documentation of the Indigenous Movement. They have collections of the documentation of their work that includes some indigenous video. But there isn't like a centralized archive of global indigenous media, and that media is all produced in analog formats that will need to be transferred and digitized if we want to teach it, if we want to study it, if we want to keep it within the contemporary formats that we're viewing in. But I want to end on a more positive note, and I would like to show you one of the festivals that has done an extraordinary job of shifting into the digital. So Fikwal Mapu is an offshoot from the Tlacpi Festival, this rotational festival that goes across Avialala. And the festival has a web presence, and this link is online, it's live. And here, first of all, these festivals have gone and taken a global approach, have included Afro-diasporic films and have awards for Afro-diasporic films or jurors that are Afro-Indigenous or African-American. So our Fikwal Mapu team has launched an online film festival and has had outdoor screenings and has tried to, like I said, democratize this media, but they understand that not everybody's gonna intuitively know how to find the films. So they've created a video that shows you how to register and watch their films.
¿Te gustaría ver cine indígena en tu casa? Quiñe, entra a www.ficualmapu.cl. Epu, en la esquina superior derecha, haz clic en el botón ingresar, registrarte hoy y completa la ficha. Hela, en la barra superior del menú, presiona películas, donde encontrarás el catálogo. Aquí podrás conocer cuáles son todas las películas seleccionadas por Fikwal Mapu y tener acceso a cientos de títulos liberados. Recomendamos utilizar el buscador. Meli, selecciona la película y ya podrás verla. Esperamos tus comentarios. Además, te invitamos a navegar por nuestro sitio web. En la sección Festival encontrarás la información sobre nuestra sexta versión a celebrarse en enero del 2021. En Noticias podrás informarte sobre nuestras últimas actividades y columnas de Pulamian colaboradores. Comunidad, donde podrás revivir todos los capítulos de Cine en Torruca, además encontrar las últimas publicaciones de nuestras redes sociales. En Educación, podrás acceder a los archivos de foros y talleres que hemos realizado en distintos territorios. ¡Ewain! ¡Nos vemos!
So one of the things that the festivals are also doing is using the language. And I feel like indigenous language film is going to be the next thing, the next wave in indigenous filmmaking. There are a few festivals now that are starting to look for work only in indigenous, minoritized or endangered languages. Our festival at the Smithsonian, we have a new festival called the Mother Tongue Film Festival. And we are receiving works from all over the world. So it's been a moment of engaging indigenous made video with film from all over the world with the commonality that it's in the language, but we understand that cinematic language lends itself to traditions that are not necessarily dependent on writing, right? Traditions that are more oral. So I'm increasingly encouraged to see young indigenous filmmakers who are not just picking up the camera, but also picking up their mother tongue to make films and tell stories in their own language. And that includes, you know, that will impact the creation of I think, a very distinct cinematographic language as well. So in closing, many many innovative tactics and methodologies have been creatively developed by Indigenous media projects and their collaborators, trainers, and film festival organizers to challenge the basic assumptions of film practice. And they surpassed expectations that anybody could have had about Indigenous video production across the region. The festivals and agencies that have consistently screened this work have effectively worked in collaboration, and they've worked transnationally and in reciprocity with Indigenous producers, contributing to the greater exposure of self-produced Indigenous thought. They are now responding to the challenge of increased isolation brought on by the pandemic by launching online film festivals, gatherings, workshops, and conversatorios, or nucham. While there's still limited connectivity, not just in underserved remote areas, but across Avellala overall, those who can get online are tapping into new audiences through online events that are free to access, that are well promoted, and that offer translation or are in Spanish or in mother languages. Indigenous languages and visions are now streaming at an unprecedented number of electronic platforms. The precarious nature of archival and preservation efforts around this media deserves greater attention and collaboration, so future generations may appreciate these works and continue to explore and expand the Indigenous audiovisual universe. But it is my hope that the creativity being put at the service of the current moment's challenges will give greater visibility to Indigenous produced works across the world, will draw attention to critical issues facing Indigenous lifeways, to the Indigenous territories, and to issues of our home planet, and return our languages, knowledges, and stories to our communal fireplace, or fogón. Thank you. Chaltumay.
Mari, Amalia, muchísimas gracias. Y ahora pasamos a Emil Keme, con su, también, Emil is, comes from North Carolina, University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. He will be sharing with us his thought, Indigeneity in Latin American Film, Challenging the Lens of Power. Thank you, Emil. We're still working on interpretation. I think we're close, but I know you wanted to do it in English. In Spanish, but it's your choice, I think.
Sí, disculpa, ¿me puedes dar acceso para compartir la pantalla? Creo que no puedo hacerlo.
Ya la tienes.
¿Sí? Porque me dice que solamente el host, only host.
Oh, wait a second.
Y tienes que hacerlo co-host.
Sí, es co-host. Eres co-host already.
You're
a co-host.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay, creo que ya, ¿verdad?
Perfect.
Vale. Okay. Well, speak nan, speak ich dat, speak ich iwan health, lenubiare emil keme, inach kichimaya winak, papashin kayala, inalashinak, we inach pamusmus, chukuhe inach shalahuch noch, ink over aliwuk, chuetwek ich, chuetwe saak, chuyaikle, nukaslemachim, lubinem, inkamuwah, kamula shmuth. Chetri ukush kahri ukush uleo, rumach I, uyombe, incowaral. Bueno, lo que acaban de escuchar es el idioma maya quiche, que es uno de los 31 idiomas mayas que se hablan en la región que hoy conocemos como Mesoamérica, pero también en muchas partes de la isla Tortuga. Y acabo de expresar mi gratitud por estar acá. Mi nombre es Emil Kemé y soy de la nación maya quiche. Mi ombligo está enterrado en un área que se llama Momostenango y también en Quetzaltenango, en lo que hoy es Guatemala. Y también soy parte del colectivo maya anticolonial Ixpalamkej Unakpuwinak. Y agradezco mucho la invitación de Miguel para ser parte de esta conversación. Y a la vez también agradezco al corazón del cielo y al corazón de la tierra por permitirnos este espacio para dialogar. A la vez, dado que estamos hablando de pueblos originarios, quiero reconocer que el Estado de Carolina del Norte reconoce este territorio como el pueblo ancestral de estas 8 tribus que han sido reconocidas por el Estado de Carolina del Norte. Pero también Carolina del Norte es el hogar de naciones indígenas que han venido del sur de Avellala y se han establecido acá. Personas maya canjoal, quiche, acateco, mam, zapotecas y otomís. ¿Ya? Pues bien, en los últimos años se me ha venido He venido desarrollando muchas reflexiones sobre una aproximación a la producción fílmica por intelectuales y personas no indígenas que representan al mundo indígena, pero también en la literatura. Me interesa mucho ver cómo se representan las fronteras, ¿no? en estas películas y cómo se interpretan desde los pueblos originarios. Ya, es decir, cómo interpretamos este continente, ¿no? Que ahora muchas personas lo reconocen como las Américas, pero desde los pueblos originarios no es las Américas, es Avialla, ¿verdad? Y a la vez, cómo ese continente ha sido dividido en todos estos estados-nación modernos, ¿verdad? En donde nosotros somos vistos como un problema, ¿no? Y sabemos también que estas fronteras fueron resultado de las luchas independentistas contra poderes europeos y que las fronteras son también movibles, ¿no? Sabemos que antes de 1800 este mismo continente lucía de esa manera, ¿no? Y fue estructurada, esas fronteras fueron estructuradas por los invasores españoles y portugueses, ¿ya? Entonces nosotros como pueblos originarios, me interesa ver cómo escritores indígenas, también cineastas, están repensando y activistas indígenas están repensando el continente, ¿no? Desarrollando nuevas cartografías, ¿no? Y llamo la atención al proyecto Native Land Digital, que algunos activistas de las primeras naciones en Canadá han desarrollado para recuperar los nombres ancestrales y los territorios ancestrales en lo que es este continente, ¿verdad? Llamo también la atención al trabajo del cartógrafo Aaron Carapela, ¿no? Quien ha producido un mapa del hemisferio occidental y recupera más de 3,000 nombres indígenas, ¿no? Con que las más de 1,000 naciones indígenas que sobreviven hoy en este hemisferio emplean para referirse y asociarse con ese territorio ancestral, ¿no? Me interesa ver eso. La otra cosa que me interesa es ver cómo se están interpretando las migraciones indígenas, ¿no? Especialmente del sur de Avialla a lo que hoy es Estados Unidos o la Isla Tortuga. Y se tiende mucho la academia, ¿no? Muchos académicos latinoamericanistas en particular tienden mucho a hacernos invisibles a través de la imposición de categorías como Latinx o latinos, hispanos, ¿no? Latinoamericanos o incluso afiliaciones de ciudadanía como guatemalteco, chileno, argentino, ¿no? Y eso obviamente es problemático para nosotros. Al menos yo no me considero guatemalteco, ¿no? ni me considero latinoamericano, ni me considero latino. Yo soy una persona maya quiché y tengo una historia milenaria propia. Me interesa entonces dar a conocer esa historia, ¿no? Esos orígenes milenarios, porque hemos estado acá mucho antes de la imposición de Estados-naciones modernos, así como también de la llegada de los europeos. Hay mucha evidencia, obvio, para hablar de eso. Entonces, eso es lo que me interesa, lo que me está interesando explorar en mi aproximación a las literaturas indígenas contemporáneas, así como también la producción fílmica. Y como un botón de muestra, quiero ofrecer ahora una discusión de estos temas a través de una aproximación crítica a una secuencia de la película Bird Watchers, o Observadores de Aves, del director italiano-argentino Mario Bekis, ¿no? Es esta película. Y el título que le da Bekis a esta película en italiano se puede traducir como La Tierra de los Hombres Rojos, ¿verdad? Ya, entonces, voy a apagar esto por un ratito. Entonces, como bien se sabe, el principal motivo para justificar las colonizaciones de los pueblos originarios ha sido el acceso al territorio y sus bienes naturales por parte de colonos europeos y sus descendientes blancos y criollos mestizos. De ahí que los indígenas se nos considere como un problema que debe ser resuelto a través de su eliminación física, su reemplazo por otros colonos o la asimilación a través de políticas de mestizaje, conteo sanguíneo, o también a través de cooptación al sistema dominante, para reciclar lógicas eurocéntricas basadas en un entendimiento del territorio como una mercancía a ser explotable. Para el nativo, sin embargo, la tierra natal y sus recursos naturales adquieren otra clase de significaciones asociadas a aspectos espirituales y culturales particulares. una extracción de recursos sin necesariamente considerarlos como mercancías explotables económicamente. Y estas diferencias y tensiones a propósito del significado del territorio entre pueblos originarios y colonos la ilustra perfectamente la película Birdwatchers de Marco Bekis, ¿no? Y para quienes no han visto la película, Birdwatchers retrata las luchas de las poblaciones guaraní kaiowá en lo que hoy es Brasil, por recuperar sus territorios ancestrales contra los colonos que han usurpado sus tierras. En la película, los guaraní kaiowá han sido forzados a sobrevivir en reservas asignadas por el gobierno hegemónico, donde ahora carecen de provisiones para mantenerse. Esto los lleva a tomar la decisión de dejar la reserva y retornar a su tecoá, o tierra natal, lugar donde sus ancestros están enterrados. Este territorio, sin embargo, es ahora ocupado por el terrateniente Moreiras, quien ha transformado el lugar en propiedad privada. Liderados por el cacique Nadio, los indígenas guaraní kaiowá orquestan una embestida contra el guardia que cuida el terreno y consecuentemente invaden y recuperan su tecoá. Deseo ahora mostrarles una secuencia que muestra el desenlace de esta acción, puesto que captura nítidamente esas tensiones principales entre pueblos originarios, terratenientes e instituciones gubernamentales respecto a ideas sobre tenencia de la tierra. La escena está en portugués e incluye subtítulos en inglés. La voy a compartir ahora. ¿Pueden ver? Ups,
sí.
Perdimos tu pantalla.
Perdón, ¿la pueden ver? ¿Está movible?
Perdimos tu pantalla, tienes que compartirla de nuevo.
Ah, ya, perdón. Ok, déjame ver.
Perfecto.
A terra está em litígio lá em Brasília e é a justiça que vai resolver agora o problema. Enquanto isso, Nádio, é bom você não deixar o teu pessoal entrar nas outras plantações e principalmente na sede. O Moreira vai segurar o pessoal dele e não deixar entrar na área ocupada. Se acontecer alguma bobagem, eu vou ter que colocar o efetivo da Polícia Federal na parada. Eu não quero ver a justiça desrespeitada, ok?
O senhor me desculpe, todo respeito, procurador, mas eu não sei como é que o senhor pode falar de justiça vendo essa terra invadida, uma terra legal, legalmente titulada em cartório.
Mas não preciso de quatear que você fala título, não conheço, não entendo, nem interessa também. Porque nós estamos aqui, a terra é nossa, não temos mais mato, não temos mais outras coisas para nós sobreviver, e nós estamos aqui, nós vamos ficar aqui.
Essa terra aqui, o meu pai chegou aqui há mais de 60 anos. São três gerações. Eu nasci aqui. A minha filha foi criada aqui. Eu trabalho nessa terra, de sol a sol, para fazer disso aqui um lugar produtivo. Eu planto comida, para as pessoas comerem.
Vocês ficam aqui até o Moreira sair.
Ya. Entonces, la secuencia, como podemos advertir, alegoriza toda una serie de tensiones pasadas y presentes entre pueblos originarios y colonos respecto a ideas de propiedad privada, eficiencia, productividad, soberanía, fronteras geopolíticas, historia y comunidad. La postura de Moreiras es una que se asocia directamente con la concepción europea de propiedad privada, es decir, la tierra es una mercancía a ser dominada y explotada para generar capital y riqueza. Por tres generaciones, dice el terrateniente, él y su familia han laborado y cosechado arduamente la tierra para el beneficio de la gente. Estas ideas son también intrínsecas a la idea de la modernidad adherida por los colonos europeos y a su vez sugiere que los indígenas no han aprovechado ni explotado los bienes naturales ofrecidos por sus territorios, lo que supuestamente los condena al atraso y la pobreza dentro del modelo económico establecido por los colonos. La acción de Nadio, sin embargo, interrumpe la narrativa hegemónica alegorizada por Moreiras, desafiando sus concepciones legales, económicas, culturales y geopolíticas. El comercio del puñado de tierra no solo ilustra una relación orgánica entre indígenas y el territorio ancestral, es decir, los indígenas somos la tierra misma, ¿no?, sino que también una actitud de respeto y responsabilidad que reconoce el territorio como un ser que nos ofrece sustento. Desde esa perspectiva, la tierra no es una mercancía a ser explotada, sino más bien parte esencial de la supervivencia y extensión histórica del ser indígena y, por ende, de todo ser humano. No solo eso, la acción de Nadio indica una presencia milenaria que va mucho más allá de 60 o 70 años de historia colonial. Los indígenas hemos estado y sobrevivido en la Via Yala mucho antes de la imposición de Estado-Nación modernos, como lo dije al principio, como el brasileño o mexicano o estadounidense, y mucho antes de la llegada de los europeos en 1492. Entonces, Nadio bien sabe que la colonización se caracteriza por un fraude, abuso, violencia y despojos. Esta experiencia ha fracturado la posibilidad de desarrollo autónomo, obligando a los indígenas a sobrevivir en reservas o haciéndonos refugiados o migrantes ilegales en sus propios territorios bajo formas de vida indignantes que hasta hoy definen nuestras condiciones materiales de existencia. Esto nos ha obligado a transgredir ilegalmente las fronteras geopolíticas impuestas con violencia por los colonos, puesto que nos niega esa relación física, espiritual y cultural con nuestros territorios ancestrales. Así, la transgresión de los guaraní kayahuá a las tierras privatizadas por Moreiras invoca toda una serie de historias de desplazamiento indígena forzados en varias partes del planeta. Podemos pensar, por ejemplo, en la caminata de las lágrimas de las naciones indígenas en lo que hoy es Estados Unidos, o los miles de indígenas que hemos dejado nuestros territorios en lo que hoy es Sudamérica para emigrar hacia el norte debido a políticas de terrorismo de Estado. Por ejemplo, el genocidio de mayas en Guatemala durante el conflicto armado interno, ¿verdad? O también debido a las políticas económicas extractivistas adoptadas por los Estados-Nación modernos, las cuales han involucrado encarcelamientos, asesinatos y desplazamientos de activistas indígenas que han desafiado estas políticas neoliberales. Articulo estas ideas en medio de las políticas antiinmigratorias de la administración de Donald Trump contra personas provenientes de Mesoamérica. Tales políticas han implicado la separación de niños de sus padres en la frontera México-estadounidense. Muchos de los niños son de origen zapoteco, nahua, maya quiché, cachiquel, mam, quichua, y tales experiencias también hacen eco de la separación de niñas y niños de sus padres para ser civilizados en internados indígenas que gobiernos coloniales emplearon para matar al indio y salvar al hombre. No solo se trata de la penalización por cruzar fronteras impuestas por los colonos europeos y sus descendientes, sino la reactivación de traumáticas experiencias vividas en el pasado por la imposición de nuevas políticas legales que buscan detener nuestro desarrollo existencial, cultural y político. Aprovecho para llamar la atención a un caso que se está dando ahorita en el Waimapu, en donde una machi o autoridad ancestral, Maún Johones, quien desde marzo del presente año se encuentra varada en la ciudad de Esquel, en lo que hoy es Argentina, y sin poder regresar a su hogar, que ella denomina Gulumapu, que está en lo que hoy es Chile. Y debido a las leyes fronterizas establecidas por el gobierno chileno, el cual se niega a reconocer la necesidad física y espiritual de la machi, de tener constante circulación en el Waimapu, su territorio ancestral, ¿no? Debido a la existencia de la frontera entre Argentina y Chile. Entonces, ese es el territorio de los mapuches no reconocen como Chile o Argentina, sino que lo reconocen como Waimapu, ¿no? Entonces, para volver a mi discusión de Birdwatchers, el retorno al Tecoa por parte de los Guaraní Kaiowá representa no solo ese desafío directo al colonialismo, sino también nuestro pleno deseo por restaurar una soberanía perdida a través de violentas políticas de despojo colonial. La acción de los Guaraní Kaiowá sugiere además que son los indígenas quienes deben determinar cómo ese territorio debe ser maniobrado y empleado a modo de asegurar la continuidad de su propia supervivencia como naciones indígenas soberanas. Vale subrayar aquí que estos esfuerzos por defender y recuperar territorios ancestrales no resulta ser mera ficción. En la película, el actor Kunumi Taperendi, alias Ambrosio Villalba, quien protagoniza el papel de Nadio, era literalmente un líder político que luchaba por la recuperación de los territorios de los Guaraní Kaiowá en Brasil. Y al igual que en la película, Taperendi fue asesinado en el 2013 por su activismo político. De igual forma, podemos invocar las acciones de líderes indígenas que defienden sus territorios ancestrales y los bienes naturales de la madre tierra en varias partes del planeta y que son criminalizados, encarcelados o asesinados por gobiernos hegemónicos en favor del extractivismo mercantilista. En suma, la secuencia de Birdwatchers sintetiza las condiciones históricas y actuales de nuestras luchas contra los europeos y sus descendientes, hoy traducidas a políticas económicas extractivistas en varias partes del planeta. La defensa de nuestros territorios ancestrales se actualiza con la lucha de los protectores del agua en Standing Rock, Dakota del Norte, el movimiento inactivo No Más, Idle No More, en lo que hoy es Canadá, el Ejército Zapatista de Liberación Nacional, en Chiapas, México, entre otros. Esto nos lleva a deducir que, desde una perspectiva indígena, el establecimiento de la modernidad occidental, las fronteras, ¿no?, las políticas extractivistas, a través de sus violencias coloniales, se trata de la historia de los poderosos y los beneficios de los que han gozado hasta hoy esos poderosos en base a la permanente colonización de los pueblos originarios. Mientras que las violencias coloniales para nosotros han significado permanentes despojos y paulatinas destrucciones sociales y culturales, para muchos no indígenas ha significado sus beneficios en los ámbitos económicos, materiales, sociales, legales, culturales y políticos. De ahí que no podemos entender la historia de la modernidad sin dar cuenta de ese lado oscuro, ¿verdad? De esa violencia colonial contra los pueblos originarios, puesto que Europa y los Estados-nación modernos y supuestamente independientes en las Américas se han fundado e instituido en base a genocidios masivos y la destrucción de nuestros pueblos. Estas tensiones nos llevan a definir nuestras luchas descolonizadoras como una contienda contra poderes europeos o europeizados, y por la restitución de nuestras soberanías territoriales y todos aquellos elementos de nuestras vidas indígenas que los colonialismos externos e internos hasta hoy día nos han negado. Ahora bien, nuestros procesos y proyectos descolonizadores no deben ser entendidos como luchas entre buenos y malos, indígenas versus colonos, sino más bien como complejas tramas o enredos coloniales en donde, como indica la antropóloga Osage Jean Dennison, las naciones indígenas por mucho tiempo han entendido el proceso colonial como a la vez devastador y lleno de potencialidades. La misma película de Birdwatchers alegoriza estas dinámicas con el personaje de Tito, visto aquí, este es Tito, quien desarrolla resentimientos al liderazgo de Nadio y se asocia con los colonos para orquestar el asesinato del líder guaraní. Tito, luego del asesinato de Nadio, es también ultimado cuando este ha completado los intereses de los colonos. Así pues, no debemos olvidar nunca que los éxitos de las colonizaciones europeas y colonialismos internos han sido también el resultado de la complicidad de ciertos sectores indígenas que por diversas razones han encontrado en los discursos de los colonos europeos y sus descendientes una reivindicación propia, como la oportunidad de vengar opresiones contra otros sectores indígenas u oportunidades de alcanzar posiciones de poder y privilegio anteriormente no gozadas. De ahí que Aníbal Quijano sostenga que la cultura europea se haya convertido en una seducción y una aspiración, puesto que ofrece acceso al poder. Uno de los grandes retos que tenemos es, pues, desbaratar esos binarismos simplistas y escuetos a modo de mostrar cómo enredos coloniales y las ambivalencias que caracterizan nuestras luchas y experiencias como pueblos originarios y nuestras luchas descolonizadoras. Lo voy a dejar ahí y... Muchas gracias. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. Muchísimas gracias, Emil. Y pasamos a Gustavo Furtado para el último ponente de esta sección, the last presenter for this section. And remember, the question and answer section is open. If you have questions, please, you can do it. Then, Gustavo, you can start your presentation now.
Am I now?
Yes, you are. Here you are. Thank you very much, Professor Gustavo from Duke University, Ramon Studies Department.
Great. Thanks, Miguel. Thanks, everyone. This has been great. Amazing presentations. It's nice to be part of the festival again. As I was organizing my thoughts for this presentation, I kind of changed the title a little bit to Mapping the Amazonian Moving Image from Heart of Darkness Voyages to Immersive Aesthetics. And I'm gonna I usually write in a very focused, zeroed in way about projects and films, but I'm actually wanting to think more broadly here and to paint with broad strokes in thinking about films in the Amazon. I hope that it still makes sense to everyone. I'm trying to deal with a very large corpus of films at the moment, including video films, newsreels, documentaries, fiction, in any case. And I wanted to start with a quote from a Brazilian filmmaker, Andrea Tonacci, who spent quite a bit of time working in the Amazon. And he was reflecting on that some years ago when he said that it was fundamental for me to realize that if you place yourself in a distinct reality than the one with which you are habituated, such as the case of the Amazon forest, even the order of your senses becomes altered, because for months you are deprived of straight lines and flat surfaces, having instead the diversity of details and forms that characterizes this space. You develop a fantastic acuteness of vision as well as of hearing, because the ears can see beyond the forest that is in front of you. For me, looking became like touching, because in order to walk, move through, make any gesture, or lean on anything, you have to scan the forest surfaces with your eyes. But it is your ears that see what is far, because you cannot see what's behind the forest. I find this really interesting as coming from a filmmaker, and I actually have heard other filmmakers speaking in similar ways, but in the beginning, there's an emphasis in vision becoming more acute and becoming kind of enhanced by the Amazon, the excess of form and shape and surface. But it's also vision becomes challenged and kind of remixed with the senses, right? Initially, because the forest is kind of a veil as well. It doesn't allow for depth of vision, vision being the sense that relies most on distancing, right? And that is denied by that environment. And so that the distance viewing gets taken over by hearing. So you see with your ears, and then the actual seeing slips into the realm of touch in Tonacci's description. The skinning of surfaces that are close by, right? He describes it in a way that it's almost as if seeing is like touching with invisible fingers, a tactile sort of visuality comes into play. With a sense, a slight sense of danger, right? Sort of the you have to look before you even make a gesture or touch, because you may not see things that you shouldn't touch. So you have to be looking very, very carefully. And perhaps most interesting of all is the way in which he emphasizes this idea of flat surfaces and straight lines as this sort of thing that alters the order of the senses. And here, obviously, speaking as someone who's coming from an urban environment, Tonacci was living in São Paulo, right, as an urban filmmaker, despite his investment in the Amazon. And I think it's really interesting in part because, you know, it does evoke the contrast of urban and Amazonian environments, but also kind of puts that environment in tension with a certain abstraction of space that would render it into flat lines and flat surfaces, let's say in geometry or in cartography. Right. And I want to take this quote, which I think has a lot of potential for thinking about different film practices, to trace in broad strokes what I see as three major possibilities for filmmaking in the Amazon, thinking historically of how films have been made in the Amazon, what kind of aesthetic approaches they have developed. And I will be touching on some very, things that are not other cinemas initially before I get to what I think are other cinemas. So I apologize for having some hegemonic perspectives that will come in here to illustrate my points. But I think the first modality, the first modality that I think we're all familiar with, and I will put a film that we all perhaps like to hate, a filmmaker that for some people, maybe the least favorite, for some, I think it's a great filmmaker at the same time, but is what I call the Heart of Darkness Voyages, right? And these are a mode of Amazonian representation that renders the tropical forest as jungle, right? And as a space that defies reason and overwhelms the senses of the traveler, leading to spatial disorientation, extreme physical danger, deprivation, and even madness. And it's really a widespread modality of representation that actually draws from the colonial archive and draws from actual experience of travelers whose sensorial training makes them absolutely inept to engage with this environment. As you might recall, Aguirre ends with the camera spinning around the raft and the delirious Aguirre mumbling, surrounded by monkeys and dead companions. It is not just German filmmakers who have done this. Of course, we have a great and interesting filmmaker, Armando Robles Godoy, who nevertheless has this very similar way of rendering the Amazon. This is not one of his most well-known films. It's a very interesting film, En la Selva no hay estrellas, in which the protagonist with a bag literally full of gold loses his compass and can't find his way out. And the idea of there is no stars in the selva, right? You can't see above the canopy of the trees, so you can't orient yourself by the stars. And this sense of disorientation, of being off the map, plays in. And there is a huge corpus of films along these lines. Some are very almost humorous, but it's certainly a very prevailing genre from the beginning of Amazonian filmmaking. There's a second, definitely hegemonic modality that I think has been less thought out, has been less articulated and examined in film studies, which is what I call cinematic cartographies. And here I thank Emil for bringing up maps. I was really happy to see that. So this mode deploys cinema as a sightseeing, locational, and geo-inscriptive technology that allows viewers to see and know the Amazon, know in quotes, by placing it within their already existing cognitive, geographic, and geopolitical maps of the world. If we include films that are not fiction films, I would say that this modality is actually the most dominant, the one that you see the most examples. And it's interesting how it draws, especially from its origins, it draws very heavily from the same sort of function that cartography played in the age of European expansion. It's almost like it inherits that function, and it gradually makes it more subtle, but it's that function that is at play, which is a filling in the map, right? The map is a given, and here in the Cantino Planisphere from 1502, the shape of the new continent for the European perspective is not yet clear to them, and they're like filling it in often with the commodities, right? But it's a gradual filling in of a shape already kind of determined, right? And in this stills from the film here is from Luis Thomas Hayes, an important pioneer of documentary filmmaking globally, who has not been thought of globally very much, contemporary of Robert Flaherty, of course. And this issue of the map and the images is a very common organization of those films. And there is really, there are hundreds of films that you can look at with very interesting maps, and the relation of maps and films and what kinds of maps come up has not been fully appreciated or studied. I mean, part of the effect of these films in fact, of cinema overall has been to kind of naturalize the map, right? Here's a map that's sort of a natural given, but of course it's a tremendous rhetorical move to incorporate a map. What kind of map? What sort of vision does a map represent? And so this is from a University of Pennsylvania expedition film that begins with a blank map. And to go back to Emil, right, it's like there's a tremendous erasure. There's nothing in this map. Which then gradually in the beginning of the film gets filled in with details. And then we have aerial shots, some of the first aerial shots of the Amazon. I think the first ones were 1925. And eventually we get into the footage of the Xingu and his sort of mode of exploration. And this works across a number of subgenres of documentary, ethnographic films notoriously, such as Tim Ash, Napoleon Chagnon, people probably have seen some of these films that not just have invariably the maps in the beginning, but also have charts. And it's the sort of symbolic appropriation of the Amazonian content by an established framework that is decidedly external to it, right? That precedes the encounter with that content. So the map gets filled in. These are very glaring examples. They can, of course, be more subtle, and they continued today. If you see a television documentary, they'll certainly play that. But it's not just documentaries. Fiction films do that in interesting ways too, sometimes with more in a more polysemic way. This is from a Brazilian classic, right, by Brazil, a film that travels the Trans-Amazon Highway. It's an anticlimactic climax of the film. The map here definitely shows its rhetorical function. It's not naturalized. The film is aware that the map is an assertion of the nation's territorial integrity or fulfillment that the film somewhat is ironic about. However, it's an absolutely cartographic film that makes a trajectory that viewers can repeat. It sort of provides local color, local information in the road system that not only can be traveled again, the film serving as a map, but has been traveled again in that light. In fact, recently there was a reportage that followed exactly the trajectory and compared then and now with the film. So it's sort of playing into the same cartographic modality. And even films without maps can still enact this sort of cartographic logic. And I wanted to present these two models because they are so broad and include so many films. And I think they allow for me to think about the idea, the question was new cinemas, right? And I wanted to think not just about Vídeo nas Aldeias, which I have been thinking about for a long time and writing about, but also other kinds of what I might think of new cinemas. But the third modality is what I'm thinking of as palimpsestic mappings and immersive aesthetics. This final mode represents the Amazon by drawing from the mappings of space produced by indigenous and local peoples, as well as by exploring the strategies of aesthetic immersion, plunging into the sensorial experience of being in the Amazon without succumbing or trying not to succumb to the heart of darkness modality. This also draws the most potential from Tonacci's quote with which I started, right? The sort of kind of re-education of the senses, the transformation of the ways in which we perceive space. The images here are from a film by Vigilance Aldeas made with the YMP indigenous group, Placas Não Falam. And it's a film in which the YMP are struggling to map their own territory, learning to map their own territory so as to be able to defend it, negotiate about it, ascertain their rights in their terms imposed upon them by the nation state. So they are learning that language in order to assert their rights, but in a language imposed on them. But at the same time, in this film and in many films by Vigilance Aldeas, they are also remembering, rearticulating, reflecting upon previous ways of thinking about territory and space. Right. So the quote here from YY, the YMP leader. He talks about how before there were no frontiers, only forest, pathways were made to gardens. They only traveled on those routes. And when the hunt, where there was less hunting, they would make a new path, but there was no sense of frontier. There was just this moving geography of homes, gardens, hunting grounds that evolved as needed. Other films, non-indigenous films, have done some really interesting things in exploring kind of a new possibility for cinema too. I think pushing cinema to new territories. And one film that I thought was particularly beautiful is Terras by Maya Darin. I think it's from 2009, I believe. I didn't write down the date. I'm sorry about that. And it's a film that's made on the triple border of Colombia, Peru, and Brazil. Leticia Tabatinga border, right? And one of its gestures is that it engages with the territoriality of the dwellers in this region and how their sense of social connection, of space, of relationship to space and nature has nothing to do with the national map. Right, how their connections cut across it, how they are often oblivious or outright opposed to those borders. One person describes the idea of drawing the border as cutting an arm off. So the film has this move of like doing this palimpsestic mapping, while at the same time, it practices a sort of haptic visuality in extreme close-ups. These two images here are from publicity images, but they illustrate well what this film practices, right? The close-up of a leaf, the close-up of a bark. And interestingly, those are the kinds of images that are closest to a map that the film provides, almost cartographic or suggestively cartographic, the leaf-like a network of rivers, you know, on the tree trunk, a sort of territorial map, except that the gesture is the opposite of the mapping gesture, right? It's an extreme approximation, it's a sensuous approximation of the surface of things. Some projects have radicalized, I think, to think about new cinemas. I also thought it would be interesting to think about cinema beyond cinema and to think about what new media affords to cinema, right? And one really interesting project, lots of things to discuss and to take issue with it, by the way, but I think it's really interesting as well, is Tree, which is described by its makers as a virtual reality project that transforms you into a rainforest tree. With your arms as branches and your body as a trunk, you'll experience the tree's growth from a seedling into its fullest form and witness its fate firsthand. So it gets even more invested into this sort of sensorial immersion and goes and attempts, hopes to go beyond the human. I think anthropomorphizing the tree as well as providing kind of a tree experience for a human, of transforming the viewer into someone who is feeling its body as if it was the tree. The experience ends with the forest being burned, and part of what is amazing, I think, about it also is that there's no mobility, right? You're rooted instead of being able to move. In outlining this three, you know, this is really, I feel like I'm working out how to deal with a corpus for a larger project here, but in outlining these three possibilities, I don't mean to suggest that they are autonomous, inseparable groupings, right? I think what is most interesting is that films tend to mix them in a variety of ways. And the most interesting films are most troubled with multiple gestures or attempts at escaping or reenacting certain gestures. And I wanted to end by referring to a film that has played in the festival, I think recently, that I think illustrates this very well, El Abrazo de la Serpiente, a film that, again, there's a lot to discuss and a lot to take issue with, not least of the fact that it is a bit of a Heart of Darkness film. In some ways, it really evokes that sense of Apocalypse Now, let's say, right? At the same time, it hopes to break free from established ways of seeing the Amazon and feeling the Amazon, which are somewhat signified in motifs like the compass and the map, right? The compass causes issue with the first traveler, the map here when Karamakate grabs Ivan's map and hurls in the water, which will signal a different moment of his journey that will be not just kind of a different space and territory, but an entrance in a different cosmology, or at least so the film hopes to do. But as every other film, I think that there, as you get closer, you can see what's intention in their projects, in their practices. I hope that I haven't gone over my time too much. I think I'll end here. I have a few more slides, but I think I'll end here.
Thank you so much, Gustavo. Stay there, please. And please, Emil and Amalia, could you join us for a couple of minutes? Well, I'll just send an email and a message to Professor Sofia, our keynote speaker, who will be starting hopefully in like 10 minutes time, and have enough time for her to share her wonderful keynote for us. But here are very interesting issues going on with your three presentations, and of course it's a topic of my heart too, and is this issue of how to read a production that is double, right? One is production made about indigenous peoples, indigenous territories, ways of being, and a production that is coming out of, right, of this subjects, right, in their own diversity and their own complexities, right, and Amalia was bringing the issues of how to think the visual grammar in a different way. Right? We have to read this thing across the grain, right, to understand how narratives are produced, visual narratives by them and about them, right, and the whole issue of el tejido, right. Weaving through time and through space and through communities and through issues and through etc., or issues of senti pensar, right? That is the issue of the logos is out, then how we can think through this as cultural products that will be joining the archive, the visual archives, or the archives, anthropological archives, or you know, any kind of modern archives, while they are, in fact, as Gustavo said, experience of immersion, embodied knowledge, right? Fixing knowledge through physical and emotional practicing lives. And all other things like sentipensar or corazonar, right? Like that are going against the way we look at or we take for granted these grammars that are at the end grammars, right? Alphabetical grammars that go against, you know, oral traditions and ways of being in the world that are different, as Emil was presenting. Then do we have to come up with new standards of reading this? Can we overlap, you know, cartographic visions on, you know, and other ways of cartographic in these territories, as Maya Darin does in Terras? That is a very interesting film, I agree. Or do we have to work on the two sides of the island, try to come up together in the middle? Because Emil was telling us, right, there is confrontation, there is something that has to happen, there is a struggle, we need resolution, there's a need for reparation, right? And audiovisual narratives help to move this discourse somehow, and somehow connects us to the larger tradition of Latin American cinema of the 1960s and 70s, right, in which the representation of the people, all in this case, them, is very clear, right, like an agency that's still present. But just to have a few minutes of conversation.
I mean, as when I was teaching Indigenous film at the university, I had to dedicate a whole class to the unlearning of whatever people came in with. So there's a great title of a book by Paul Chet Smith called Everything You Know About Indians Is Wrong, right? So there's a visual equivalent. It's so kneaded into the history, for example, of this country, right? So there's a lot of unsettling and shaking open to do first before you can even get people to appreciate what they're looking at. They have to lift, you got to lift those filters off, and that means unsettling the canon, unsettling the genres, right? Which are industrially based, that are created to create markets, right? And there's a big discussion on whether Indigenous film is a genre or not. I mean, right now what we're seeing is an immense blurring of genres in Indigenous film, and a different approach to treatment of sound, music, voice, multivocality, etc. So I think there is a different aesthetic, but it won't get appreciated unless you understand what's really happening there. And that requires amplifying your vocabulary and kind of understanding that there's a different ethos, there's a different knowledge and poetics at work. And that's why by curating Indigenous film, you're forced to think about foundational ways of meaning and of knowing that are contained in the films. I think one thing to really try to distance yourself from is to keep doing this kind of regional curation of saying like, oh, I'll just put all the Mexican shorts together, right? No, you should look at what they're about and try to present them and put them in dialogue with each other. And I think that's a really interesting project that Gustavo has started, because nobody's done an overview of Indigenous video of all Brazil, because it's so far scattered. And even between the Kayapo communities, there's different aesthetics, let alone the whole Amazon. So it's a huge corpus to take on. But like the West in the United States, you know, the West, it's a site of fantasy and mythology and foundational narratives too. So it's an incredibly important political project, I would say.
Thank you so much, Emil, Gustavo. Some final thoughts. We can keep the conversa in and out.
I was just gonna say what Amalia said, but she no, got into it. So I'm gonna let Gustavo have the last word.
This was great. I really enjoyed your presentations and Amalia's comment. I think that I'm obsessed with maps right now, so I really liked Emil's use of maps, because I think what is hard for us to figure out new ways to map, right? I mean, the fact is that we learn how to organize things and see things a certain way, and they inevitably produce a huge amount of unseen, and that's how it works. So you have to find ways to kind of organize, and in a very pragmatic way, how do we navigate a corpus of films that doesn't get put together, right? We think there's Indigenous film, but even that is a little fragmentary. There's ethnographic film, there is national cinema, there, right? And then if you think of the Amazon, national cinema is a tiny slice of Amazonian filmmaking, right? Indigenous film is a really interesting emerging force, right? But it's a totally transnational, multilingual, right? So it falls outside of all of our frameworks for thinking about film. And it's challenging because there's no ongoing conversation that allows you to bridge them, right? So in my obsession with like, how do I map this? I guess I am finding that how do films map things is one way to deal with that, you know? And of course, films inevitably create maps, especially in a place where placeness and nature is so, so crucial. So anyway, thanks. This was great.
I have one last thing to say. In thinking about how to combine those aesthetics and like the crossing of lines between like native made, collaborative, and non-indigenous produced, I always come back to Juan Downey when it comes to Amazonian experimental work. I wrote a little bit about him. And I'm just remembering the laughing alligator cross-cutting, you know, busy life in the city and then busy life in the village, peeling your yucca, you know, how he manages to really, really engage those geographies and temporalities. So again, disrupting linear notions and also, you know, abstract notions of what is north and what is south, what is up and what is down.
As well as Transamerica, right? Transamerica is a map.
Transamerica is an amazing series.
A map that goes up the wall.
Yeah.
The monitors are placed on the map. So it's very mixed, right? It's kind of an alignment of that map, but also, yeah, I had a slide, one of the slides that I didn't show. I would love to read your work on him, by the way.
I'll send it to you. Okay.
Yeah. Emil, any final words?
No. Thank you so much,
everybody. I mean, this is just to start conversations because we have to keep la conversa viva. Yeah? Probably, hopefully, some soon, face to face, and with some help from the plants and the gods of the plants.